Right, members, welcome. We're now at 6:30. We can start off with apologies for absence of substitutions. I haven't got any, but Councillor Robinson is on a sweaty train on the way back from London, so he shall arrive in due course looking suitably dishevelled. Do we have any declarations of interest? We do not. Urgent matters. It's not on the item because we weren't sure from the last meeting. Do we have any nominations for the position of Vice Chairman? Right. Minutes of the last meeting will be coming to the next meeting from last week. And then I have housekeeping, don't I? Which is the fire evacuation procedures for evening meetings. There are no fire alarms scheduled for this evening. Therefore, if the fire alarm sounds, please evacuate the building immediately. The fire exits are located at the rear and side of this room. Go down the stairs and meet in the War Memorial Park. This meeting is being webcast live on the internet, which it is. And please, all members and members of the public, switch their phones off to silence, switch them off or turn them to silent, please. We've got two substantive items this evening. The first of which is a refresh of the housing and homeless strategy. We have Kate, Councillor Reid, and Erin Cahill coming to present to us. So with no further ado, Councillor Reid.
Thank you very much, Chair, and good evening, members. So I will do, I'll say brief, it's not entirely brief, but it will be as brief as I can make it, an introduction. Then I'll hand over to Erin, who has a presentation, and then of course we can move into questions because we have Erin and Kate here as well, so very happy to take any questions or points you might like to raise. So first of all, before I actually go into a full introduction, I need just to state my enormous thanks and gratitude to the officers who've worked so hard yet again. I have felt very privileged over the last couple of years to have this portfolio and to work with such an amazing team of officers who are constantly looking for innovative new ways of dealing with the problems that are forever confronting us. I couldn't possibly name everybody, but I will name a few. Kate, of course, for her leadership of the housing team, which is amazing. Nothing is ever on the too difficult pile for Kate. And I'm always so impressed with that. She's always ready with new ideas, and she's always willing to listen to new ideas as well, which is what we absolutely need in the current climate. Karina, who isn't with us tonight, who deals with our rough sleeping strategy and the social inclusion partnership and all the work around supporting people, which again has been absolutely phenomenal in the last couple of years. Karina has been incredible with partnership working and also with the pioneering cross-cutting work that she's been doing, and I'm so impressed with that. Must also thank Erin, who has joined us for the housing strategy and has led the consultation on that. His expertise and experience on this has been invaluable, and he's always cool and analytical, which is just what we need on this. And then finally, Kathy, who's not here either, but Kathy Farr, just for her general enthusiasm and dedication and leading her team on everything. So I'll stop that now, but I just want it on record because I think officers have been absolutely amazing. So we needed to reevaluate the housing strategy in the context, members will be aware, of course, of national and local changes that were going on. So nationally, we have the background, the framework of the Housing and Planning, what was Bill but is now an Act, with the direction to local councils to prioritise low-cost home ownership and bring opportunities forward for that. And then locally, of course, changed context in terms of the new local plan, which is now adopted, with increased housing numbers. Also, the continuing problem of lack of affordable housing delivery, which we faced over the last few years. And also the different model that the local RSLs seem to see for themselves now, which is moving to a more mixed delivery rather than simply social rent. So as a result of that, we embarked on the consultation, and the results that we received from the consultation are now driving the direction of the strategy as we move on. So within that, we have several key points. We have, first of all, of course, a continued commitment to protect and assist the vulnerably housed and homeless. I cannot overestimate how amazing this work has been for the last 2 years. We have, as a result of the work that we've had to pick up because of the cuts to supporting people, we have the developing rough sleeper strategy. We have the partnership work of the SIP, the Social Inclusion Partnership. which includes, for example, the Making Every Adult Matter pilot, which we are running here, which is taking the top, it should be around the top 12 or top 15 most complex cases amongst the homeless or rough sleeping or vulnerably housed in Basingstoke, and actually trying to address those really complex difficulties that they face. We are working with BVA on a crowdfunding platform, which I think is now live. Space Hive, I got the word right, haven't I? Space Hive, which is driving extra funding, really, from outside. People who want to help, who want to assist with homelessness, it's in a direction for them to help them to understand what's going on and to direct that money towards specific projects. So, for example, a wet room for Camrose and various other projects that will come up. We are working with Southampton University with Dr. Nick Maguire, who is, make sure if I get this right, Associate Professor of Clinical Psychology at Southampton University, who has done some absolutely incredible pioneering work over the last few years on psychologically informed environments, which is actually looking at what can you do to actually deal with people who are at the absolute rough end of society, who are homeless, who have suffered from complex traumas throughout their lives, and who are not going to react in what people would consider to be the usual way to a situation. And it's getting them help and assistance to learn to deal with their surroundings and actually start to perhaps genuinely move on, rather than just a sticking plaster approach. And it's also helping all those services and agencies around them to understand what their role is and to understand why people behave the way they do and how we can actually serve and help those people better. As part of the SIP, we also have shared information and resources. We have so many partners around the table now, health, mental health, ambulance services. So we have that shared information, that shared expertise, and also potentially shared savings. We have the possibility now of a winter night shelter, which has come through from the SIP as well, which is likely to emerge through the churches. We have the offer of that from them. We're working with them now to bring that forward for this winter, which I think will be a huge step forward. And then, of course, alongside that, we've been maintaining the provision of the Joshua Tree and increasing the number of ESPs to continue to reduce bed and breakfast, to make sure that families are not put into bed and breakfast but have suitable temporary accommodation. All this work is absolutely groundbreaking, and it's received national attention, and it's also receiving the attention of government. So that's our first enshrined position. Another position that we want to make sure that we're taking is an enabling role to help deliver more affordable housing. We all know that we are missing and have been missing targets on the delivery of affordable housing. So we now have senior officers who are tasked with that role, with seeking innovative opportunities and innovative partners to look at new ways of delivering affordable housing, including social rent. And also, our review of the allocations list a couple of years ago means that we are maintaining that social rent that we have at the moment for those who clearly need it most and who also have a local connection, both of which came through very clearly in the consultation we had on that. Our next position will be looking at the provision of low-cost home ownership, discount market sale, shared ownership, and the clear need and want for that from our residents, which has come through so strongly in the consultation. And also it's evidenced by the Facebook advertising that we undertook for the Help to Buy event and the actual event itself, where we had over 300 people through in just a few hours. Phenomenal response. People were literally queuing to get in and queuing to get advice on how they could access home ownership, different types. And then also, I mean, just to underline that need, Sentinel have told us that over the last year they have had something like 1,600 inquiries for around 160 opportunities for shared ownership. So 10 times the amount of opportunities they had, they could have filled them 10 times because of local people who want shared ownership. And even in the last couple of months, where they have no shared ownership opportunities available and they haven't marketed it at all because they've got nothing to give, they have still had over 300 inquiries. And then, of course, if you talk to estate agents and developers, they all report massive oversubscription on shared ownership schemes. So we want to reflect that quite clearly in the new strategy. And our previous position on housing, I think, in Basingstoke's Dean has been really not to go there, not to talk about that. We tend to have fairly limited conversations when we talk about housing. But why wouldn't we want to help more of our residents? If we're already making sure that we continue to support those who need help, why shouldn't we also want to help those who are saying to us, we want to access home ownership of whatever kind? Why shouldn't we want to encourage aspiration and ambition? And I think we're absolutely right to reflect that. So we are positioning ourselves in enablers in bringing forward opportunities such as discount market sale, shared ownership, low cost home ownership, and intermediate rent. As part of that, we are putting forward an intermediate housing list, which will collect names of people who want to access that kind of thing, and then put those forward, those names, as local names, put them forward for local opportunities for this. And an added bonus from this, I've spoken to many developers and investors who say that this list would actually greatly encourage them to bring those opportunities forward because it's ready-made marketing for them. And also, it could potentially have the benefit of enabling move up from social rent. So those people who are in social rent who could afford that first step up into some kind of shared ownership, for example, if we can help that and enable that, that then frees up those social rent properties as well. And then the other message that came through very clearly from the strategy was the need for older persons accommodation. And again, we're not talking here so much about extra care. We're talking about people who want more flexibility, who want to downsize and who want equity release on their properties and who are limited in their options at the moment. And obviously with an aging population, this will increase this need and we want to continue to support that. So basically the strategy aims to help even more people from a wider demographic than we've helped before. Our commitment to the vulnerable is absolute and it will continue and our actions have demonstrated this. So what we're proposing is an addition to this work. It's enabling aspiration, it's enabling ambition and it's giving people a stake in the future. It allows our residents a much more varied and flexible range of options and we will be much more proactive in enabling this. I am hugely proud, as I've already said, and I probably say ad nauseam, of the work we've already undertaken around homelessness and SP and the achievements of the last couple of years. I'm also immensely proud of this new housing strategy. It marks a new direction of travel for us, and I believe it builds a bright future for so many more of our residents, while still giving help to those who need it. Absolutely, housing is about dealing with homelessness. It's about dealing with homes for rent. But it's also far more than that. It's about those residents who dream of finding a first home to own, a step on the ladder for themselves and their family to prevent them ever becoming an emergency and requiring more intensive help. And it's about those older people who have contributed to the community all their lives and now need a little help to access a home that better suits their needs. It's about providing choice and flexibility and a range of options to open up the market and to help as many residents as we can. I am personally hugely excited at this opportunity that we have to provide opportunity to the people of Basingstoke, making a brighter future for so many more. So I will now hand over to Erin, who will give us the presentation on the consultation.
Thank you, Councillor. What I'll do is just spend, about 10 minutes just running through the PowerPoints that I've prepared here with colleagues, and apologies to those who've heard them before. I mean, broadly, the purpose of the housing homelessness strategy is to give a overall direction of travel to the council's vision for housing in the borough, so to set out the priorities that are things important, and then individual policy actions that are designed to actually implement that, those priorities. Obviously addressing affordable housing needs, both those in affordable need of affordable housing that's rented, as well as that for affordable home ownership, and then other forms of housing such as intermediate rent, as well as market housing itself. But obviously the focus for this is primarily affordable housing. The point also is to align it with other documents that the council has in place, often with local authorities. Documents aren't often talking to each other, so it's quite important for this exercise to ensure that the local plan was quite clearly marked out as a kind of defining document for the spatial development of the borough, and then also the council plan itself, which was adopted early in the year. So it's quite a good opportunity to actually bring these things together and try and set out a kind of coherent story for housing for the borough in the next 4 years or so. So just seeking to master the technology, here we go. So the national context, obviously there was a general election last year and there was some very significant changes to housing policy that were set out by national government. Obviously a very strong preference for affordable home ownership. The government have made clear through the Homes and Communities Agency that future funding will be only for affordable home ownership, principally shared ownership, and a new product called the Starter Homes, or Starter Homes, under the Starter Homes Initiative. Other actions that are flowing are still welfare reform rolling out, particularly through the new universal credit. Obviously, continued delays with the implementation of that, but the direction of travel is still to implement that. And then some other initiatives for council housing, obviously not applicable here at the moment, but pay to stay for high income council tenants, that will be imposed. That's going to be as rolling out shortly. And also fixed term tenancies for council tenancies. So we've got the irony of lifetime tenancies staying with housing association organisations, but fixed terms being implemented for council tenancies. And then there's the voluntary extended right to buy as well, so for housing association tenants. So what council tenants have been benefiting from over the last 30 years or so is now being extended to the housing association sector, but on a voluntary basis. So housing associations would actually need to agree at board level that they wish to take on that that option for its tenants. And then there's a broader agenda around deregulating housing associations activities. So there'll be less, if you like, regulation of housing association activities. So more freedoms to perhaps sell stock that becomes void to fund other activities, and other freedoms which are still yet to be published. But in time on the way, local authorities will be keeping some of the more challenging responsibilities that they currently have, and homelessness duties are remaining as are, and possibly becoming more onerous in future years. But at the moment, no published duties changes there. But overall, a reduction in government intervention in affordable housing for the future, in as far as affordable rented accommodation is concerned. So, next slide. So the response, late last year I was asked to undertake prepare a framework document. It was almost like a pre-housing strategy, just to look at the issues and options that the council's facing. And I met a number of you to actually run through these issues, and got good feedback from opposition members and also other stakeholders such as the housing associations, police representatives and other stakeholders. So very much an issues and options discussion, and the headlines of that are one of the annexes that are in your papers today. And then there was a consultation on a revised housing strategy, so that started back in February and began ended in late March. And the priorities identified in there was around increasing delivery of affordable housing, both rented and low-cost home ownership, but particularly improving dissemination and promotion of low-cost home ownership itself, often seen as a bit of a sideline activity for housing organisations, particularly housing associations. But the framework document and the subsequent draft strategy actually did give more of a prominence to affordable home ownership, because there is much latent demand, and obviously where there are sons and daughters and those tenants themselves, where they want to actually move into that kind of accommodation, but still stay in the local area, which is often what people want to do, stay in their friends and family networks. Very limited options, and as we heard before, you know, for every 10 people inquiring, there's one kind of option available, and not necessarily in the place that they want to live. So there's a very unmet demand there, and both the framework document and the housing strategy did seek to promote that more proactively. approve services and products for vulnerable people and homeless people, and we've Councillor Reid made mention of older people's housing options. This isn't obviously unique to Basingstoke and Deane, is a national issue. People not being not having options to either scale down to where they're living from where they're living presently, and generally many of the products, you know, of sheltered housing in local government, I'm more familiar with. The product's a little bit tired, not enough investment being put into them, and you know, people are living longer, and lifestyles aspirations are as a very you know, ongoing. It's not like people are putting their slippers on and you know, retiring, but very much active throughout their lives. And then there's a broader issue around just taking a leadership role. I think there's an issue around adrift, really. I don't think there's been real ownership of housing delivery in the borough in the last 2-3 years or so. And I think there's been needs to be much more you know, proactive intervention. The council has resources, land, it does have some money available, and it does have expertise. So there's quite a lot that the council have to offer, and affordable housing, and particularly market housing, is primarily private sector led, housing association led. So really the council role is around coordination and facilitation. So the engagement process, I've slipped up now. I'll just talk to it, there's only a few headlines. Consultation process went from early February to end of March. We had online survey responses, 282. We would have liked a few more responses, closer to 400, but it was a good response, I thought. One-to-one meetings with stakeholders, and one very well attended stakeholder event very early in the consultation process, and five written responses from a number of stakeholders. So a good range of respondents, and there was also the feedback that I managed to get from the framework development process as well. So that was it was a good response and quite a reasonable engagement process. In terms of what did people say, I mean, overall there was strong support for the priorities, even support for the importance of affordable rented and low-cost home ownership housing. So I was, you know, kind of had an open mind as to what was coming back, but you know, certainly a balance, but certainly a need to actually promote low-cost home ownership housing more proactively, and private rented housing seen as least important. And in terms of priorities for people accessing intermediate housing, like shared ownership, essential workers were considered important, but there was also a feeling that local people should have priority and not necessarily according to what job they were actually doing. So very much people who had lived in the borough for longer should have perhaps more priority than people who are necessarily essential workers for a few years. Second phase, really, of second range of comments, strong support for growth, which is not necessarily a given, and many down was referenced a number of times. Older people's housing, a priority, first time buyers, the highest priority, preference to building in the town as opposed to the rural areas and villages, and then a strong theme around the transport infrastructure and also community infrastructure. You know, GP surgeries, schools, you know, you can talk about the housing, but if you don't provide the company infrastructure, then you're just storing up problems for a later time. So changes to the document, we updated it, edited it a little bit long in parts, aligned it with the council plan and the local plan that was adopted while we were updating the document, and more of a goal-orientated target setting, so very much keeping some of the output-driven targets, but also focusing on some actions around refreshing the approach to rough sleeping, and also reviewing how the council approaches housing-led regeneration. And then the plan is to adopt the final document in the autumn. in a full council. So just to reiterate some of the, just highlighted some of the areas where there was support for and how we responded to that in the strategy, and then some of the actions that we were identifying to be undertaken. So the low-cost home ownership register, for example, ongoing promotion of housing delivery, and just finally keeping up the approach to homelessness prevention through the social inclusion strategy and rough sleeping strategy, particularly more temporary accommodation options. And then the leadership role, trying to bind it into the social inclusion exercise and the work of the strategic partnership locally, and review the approach to regeneration. And those are the highlights, really: accelerate development, broaden the housing options, and support the vulnerable and the homeless. Okay.
Very good. Members, questions? Councillor Frost.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I'd like to congratulate officers for what's been a very comprehensive paper. It's a subject very close to my heart. But I do have just a couple of questions. The first one is on the housing list, which has been trimmed from 8,000 people down to 2,000 people that have been actively seeking. I'm a little unsure, but how were people contacted to make sure that, one, they were still actively seeking, and two, can you please tell me just how easy it is to come on and off, you know, the housing list as people's circumstances change? Because I have to say I have been very fortunate enough never to have been on the housing list.
There was a very elongated process in terms of introducing the changes. It took place over a number of months, during which we contacted people either in writing or through messaging when people were coming through on choice-based lettings. I can actually provide you with the report that we did at the time, which actually goes into some detail around the actions that we took. And people had a long cut-off time as well, and a sort of unwritten period of still able to come back to us after the cut-off date, which was in October 2015. The work that we'd done to speculate what sort of people would come off was predicated on an assumption that around half the people on the list weren't either active or in housing need at some point. So we were fully anticipating a large change in the numbers. That happens in any event, whether or not you're closing down the criteria. You'll find that people just don't hear the letter, don't read the letters, and then come back on. I think we went down to about 1,300 on day one of October 2015, and then it's been a sort of gradual spike back up, which is now levelling up, and we're about 2,500 on the housing register at the moment. It's not a once gone, forever forgotten, because if people at any point in their housing histories have a housing need and are eligible and qualified to come on, they can come on. This was about making sure that people who come on anew or wanted to stay on did have that housing need and did have that local connection. And bearing in mind as well, this is only the housing register for the social rented and affordable rented units to which we have nomination rights through the housing register. So one of the reasons why we've identified building up a sort of database and a list around affordable housing and intermediate housing is the fact that if we just purely rely on the information we glean from the housing register, we're going to be selling ourselves short. So we've put some time into thinking about the methods that we will do to sort of harvest that information and build it up into a list. And we are now in the process of sort of starting that second database, if you like, of information. But to go back to sort of the original question, in terms of easy to come on and off, coming on is as easy as making an online application. The facilities are there for people to do that, and they're assessed in accordance with the criteria. And if the answer is you're not eligible and circumstances change even a week later, then still that reapplication could be made. So it's a very, very fluid activity.
Thank you very much. I'd appreciate the report if possible. Thank you.
Councillor Harvey.
Thanks, Chair. On page 11, 3.2 of the report, it talks about the risk assessments, the risk issues associated. And while the assessment is at this stage looking at the risks of doing or not doing the strategy, have you done the risk matrix, the associated analysis of the proposals that are in here, or is that yet to come? And if so, when will we get to see that part of your assessment set against the risk strategy of what you're actually proposing?
In terms of risk assessment is part of implementation of any decision or any action that you do. It's not necessarily documented in any sort of encyclopedic form in terms of, you know, for every action we take every day. So the risk analysis for undertaking the strategy is contained in the report. We haven't gone into the detail of risk assessing every single action other than what we would normally do in the normal event of things.
Thanks, Kate. It is a housekeeping point in some respects, but it's also important. We are supposed to, if you have a decision of this magnitude, have the risk assessment attached to it in order that, as members, we can be assured by it. So I appreciate what you're saying, but it's the strategy. Yeah, but in terms of what you're saying, the actual proposals, not just whether you do it or don't do it. That's my point. So if you could think about that in terms of how it would be presented, because this isn't the final stage, is it? We're not going to not see this again in terms of you bringing it back. The cabinet member's going to take this forward as a cabinet decision. So at that stage, I'd like to see the full-on risk assessment of what's being proposed. My second question really relates to 49, page 49, where it talks about the funding. Council funding to support the delivery of the strategy. Lots of paragraphs there about various sources of funding. The one that's missing is the alternative investment fund, that £25 million that we've put aside. Is that not in here for a particular reason, or should it be in there really, in the sense of saying that is a fund that I would have expected we would be drawing against for these sorts of important things?
The alternative investment strategy funding is there with criteria for its release, of which housing and delivery of affordable housing could be one of those initiatives to bring forward. So, but it's not specifically earmarked for housing. You know, because it's not earmarked specifically for housing, that's not part of the dedicated focus resources identified to deliver this strategy, but it could form a component part or associated part of any other initiative.
Good answer, but what I'm looking for there is that it should be. I mean, that money is available to be used. It is there under criteria. It's set down as to what can and cannot be done. And during those maps and during the conversations on the use of that money, it was pushed very hard by a number of us, cross-party, that it should be looked at as a fund for housing initiatives where it should come forward. I appreciate it's not specific, but it is an important fund we should be looking to.
Can certainly do in readiness for preparation of cabinet reports is take advice from, you know, the council's section 151 officer and the finance team in terms of how they want to. Financial matters aren't something for me necessarily to go into any detail of, but I would certainly pick up the point and take it up with them.
Councillor Rattigan.
Thank you, Chair. If we go to page 11 of the report, financial implications, 3.12. It says that we received £99,700 from the government to prevent homelessness. It says there it's not ring-fenced. I really would like to see that money ring-fenced. And is there any reason why it isn't ring-fenced? And can you do more to make sure it is ring-fenced? Because I think it's, if it's allocated, it should be there.
I guess that's a matter for government in terms of the funding that it gives and the conditions that it attaches to it, and also, secondly, the council in terms of how it wishes to earmark unring-fenced funds. If it gives any consolation, that money is earmarked for the budget that supports the supporting people, social inclusion, homelessness, delivery of services, which totals in the region of 111,000. So we actually contribute more than what we get in from grant from the government. Plus there are other associated budgets that sit within the homelessness budget around rent bond, homeless prevention. So yes, it's not ring fenced. I'm not sure that's within certainly that the portfolio holders gift alone, but in any event, the amount that is spent on homelessness prevention exceeds what comes in through the grant.
If I may, Chair, can I just add to that then? You, on 3.13, in addition to this, the council provides additional funding of 146,400. That's £250,000 in total, essentially, for our homelessness and the prevention measures. Can we not ring fence, if we can't ring fence the government bit of money, can we not ring fence the equivalent amount out of our own budget for homelessness? I mean, it doesn't seem beyond the wit of man to be able to juggle those figures. So as we have a determined amount of money that we cannot use for any other purpose.
I would probably need to defer to one of the finance team only to answer that in the sense of how the policy and budget framework actually allows for that to go into the budgets. But it's certainly a comment that's noted, and I will take back from this meeting and report back to my finance colleagues.
Councillor Reid.
Sorry, there is a 4 million homeless fund within the corporate budget, which we can draw down on for homeless related matters.
Then can we make sure some of it is ring-fenced only for that purpose? And if in light of lots of strategies for homes, homelessness, the vulnerable, if we could show that we are allocating money to them, and we'll look at reviewing that ring-fenced amount in the future, I think that would be a positive step.
Thank you. Councillor Watts.
Thank you, Chair. Continuing on the theme of funding, I was in the paper that's going to council tomorrow, and it's on the outturns paper. It indicates that we underspent by 100,000 on housing, 60,000 of that was on homelessness strategy. Could you give me some detail where that lag is, please?
Yeah, that was in relation to the work that we're doing on housing strategy that is straddling financial years, so it wasn't necessarily an underspend, but it's something that we forecast was going to be required to continue the work on through into this financial year.
Right, so it's a carry forward then, so it's not an underspend then. Yeah, fair enough, semantics. Just going on to some of the government things, starter homes, I take we haven't got any starter homes in Basingstoke at the moment. I just noticed that the new starter homes are gonna have a lower standards. That's why they're cheaper. I'm wondering if you can give us details of what those low standards are.
I'm not aware that they're going to be lower standards as such. I think there's, we're obviously due the publication of the regulations to do with starter homes, but I think there'll be, I can't really accept that there'll be a lower standard. I think there'll be an issue about the house type that will be coming forward. So obviously if the council is required to deliver 20% of its outturn as starter homes, a developer comes forward and says, well, I'll deliver you 20% all in as bed sets, then obviously that's not quite an acceptable return. So I'd say that in qualitative terms, that's a lower standard, so you'd want a range. So I think there's still a bit to come out in terms of regulations and how individual local authorities respond to them. So I think early days, yeah. But it will be down to the council to have a robust SPD in place to ensure that the standards and qualities that you're expecting in the locality are met by the starter homes that will be required in the future.
Exemptions is 106 monies. Again, that's putting burdens on the infrastructure, and the developers aren't paying their way. I mean, how are we going to make up the shortfall for all these starter homes with no 106 money? Have we got a plan in place for that? I'll take that as a no, so that's probably...
Well, I think there's still a lot to come out in terms of regulations and detail to actually be coming to a view as to how the council decides to respond to that. But it's starter homes is a rather challenging affordable housing product. I don't think there's anybody in the housing industry that doesn't have its concerns about what might turn out in the future, but I think it'd be a case for individual local authorities, planning authorities, to ensure they've got, you know, a robust suite of documents in place to ensure what comes through is what the council, within reason, wants to see.
Thank you, Chair. I think once we get the details, it'd be good for this committee to actually see what is in those proposals from the government, and we can dissect them and put a strategy in place to mitigate any circumstances and loss in standards and 106 money. Going on another question, on the pay to stay, councils, I take, we haven't got any council property, they have to have over 30,000, they have to pay extra charges. Do we are aware of what our housing association's doing? Because we've got over 23 housing associations. Are we aware of they're going to be voluntary, or they're going to be penalising the poor people of Basingstoke just on a meagre salary of £30,000?
No, we don't know yet, in the sense that these are powers and options that they have available, and we're not aware of any of our providers yet sort of adopting that as a policy provision. I mean, there's masses of work involved in terms of understanding and harvesting the information on what incomes are, and et cetera, and what the implications might be. So, in fact, I'm not aware of any housing associations nationally that have started rolling out pay to stay.
Just to add to Kate's point, I think there's a general consensus that the money that may be collectible might be more trouble than it's worth, and the actual mechanism for working out who, you know, what households actually earn is not going to be very easy. I mean, for local authorities, it may, you know, it's being imposed, so there's not really a choice there, and there is a proposal that local authorities may talk to the HMRC about how to assess household incomes, but obviously households are, you know, can be quite fluid things, so it's be quite difficult to, you know, crystallize what a household income is a year or two after the event. So my gut feeling is that housing associations will be avoiding that certain pleasure for the moment.
Councillor Reid.
Just briefly to add that we do obviously have regular housing briefings for all members, and we get the RSLs to come along to that and to talk about the situations. They have done recently a couple of times, so we're planning another one for the autumn. So it's worth, obviously, when you have concerns, to come along, because you can then question them directly and get it straight from the horse's mouth.
Councillor Richards.
Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I'd like to congratulate the officers and portfolio holder on this report. I think it's an excellent report, clearly well thought out and deep in thought, and much compassion in there. One point that I was interested in was this business of homelessness and the project that's running with Southampton University. I just wonder, I mean, obviously the outcome presumably is to try and rectify the behaviour of certain people. Can I ask at what stage you're at with this, and how you see the thing progressing?
How long have you got? Cause I could Southampton University's theory around psychologically informed environments is that essentially, if you understand the sort of traumas that happen in people's lives to cause homelessness, you can better respond to that. So it's responding to homelessness and its causes and delivering solutions which are based on that understanding, rather than things like we need X number of units, we need X number, you know, in X Y location. So it's a much more person-centered approach. We came across the work that Southampton are doing partly because it's quite pioneering, and it's something that's being sort of developed nationally, albeit in a very few number of places. But it was always also very much in vogue with the impetus that the supporting people work had picked up around, actually, if we're going to take on and commission these services, we want them to be good services and we want them to be outcome focused. So that resonated really well with what we learned from Southampton University. In terms of where we've got at the moment, we have a mandate to work with them from cabinet, from, you know, the cabinet members, if you like, not a cabinet decision. So we have been developing a project sort of outline, which essentially takes some time to review the services that we've got, analyses the impact of those services against sort of PIE principles, and then we'll come forward with some recommendations on what service improvements we can make as a result of that. I mean, it affects every aspect of homeless service commissioning and delivery, not just from what buildings look like, but what support packages should look like and what cultural values you should instill in the staff that you're recruiting to do homelessness work, either on a support basis or in any other sort of capacity. And one of the things that we've been keen to do is to include the work of our statutory homeless team into that work, because it's almost sort of no point asking support providers to adopt an approach that we're not also doing ourselves. So, you know, it can have any range of different examples, to how we offer appointments, to how we deal with the sort of anger and disappointment that people often express during their interviews with us. And it's also about reflective practice in terms of understanding how to take what's just happened, reflect upon it, put it into a sort of a theoretical framework, and then move forward from that. So, yeah, I could talk for hours on it, but I won't. But in a nutshell, a big nutshell, that's what it is.
Thank you very much indeed. That was very, very interesting. And again, you know, I congratulate you on taking a different approach. And hopefully, and we look forward in the future to seeing how this progresses. Well done. Thank you.
Councillor Reid.
Just to expand on what Kate said, the thing that struck me when I met Dr. Nick for the first time was what he was talking about was just almost comes across as very basic common sense. It's approaching someone, you know, entrenched rough sleepers are the most difficult problem to solve. You know, you can find, if you can engage with them, and frequently you can't, and if you can find them somewhere to stay potentially, but that doesn't solve the problem because they keep going round in a circle and coming back to services all the time. So it's looking at their specific needs, their background, which is frequently chaotic, traumatic. That affects everything they do. They don't have the emotional resilience that most people who have had a less difficult background have. So they react differently and more strongly to things. And the idea that, you know, someone who is going through a homeless service is coming and dealing with meeting staff who actually have, despite all their experience and despite whatever support the staff have had and whatever they dealt with, they don't actually have the psychological insight always and the psychological training to understand how to deal with someone when they're presenting with really difficult problems and really difficult behaviours as well. And as I say, it is so common sense to say that everything you do around people with that set of difficult problems has to be guided by this kind of psychological basis. Once you hear it, you think, well, why haven't we been doing this forever? I could go on forever as well, but it is remarkable, it really is.
Councillor James.
Thank you. Can I ask a question on the main achievements, first of all, of the strategy? It's the second bullet point from the end, page 15. 253 new affordable housing units gross over the 2013-15 years were delivered, although this remains short of the 300 target. I just think it's very creative to put this down as an achievement. This is over 3 years. We have a target of, and it doesn't say that on there, a target of 300 houses a year, and we only delivered 253 units, and that's gross, not net. Why are we putting gross down? We should be putting net. We've had this argument before. So to hold this up as an achievement, I would have thought this is one of those issues that we would raise as a concern, and what are we going to do about it, and how, and this is about what this strategy is doing in relation to delivery. But that's my first point, if you could just answer that.
Councillor Reid.
I think there was a question in that, how are we dealing with this?
Sorry, this was held as an achievement. I don't think this is an achievement that we only delivered 253 units over 3 years when our target is 300 units per year. So that's 900 units. Why is that held in in this area as an achievement?
Well, we could argue about what's an achievement or what isn't, clearly. I mean, this is a list of milestones, of things that have happened over the last few years. I mean, it's a fact that that number of affordable homes have been delivered. No one is happy with that. Not at any point are we saying that is something to be proud of. I mean, I've already referenced it. That's why we have set up this mechanism within the council where senior officers are meeting this head on and they're looking to actually find opportunities to proactively seek partners and developers. So quite clearly, you know, this is an important part of the strategy, absolutely. No one is saying that that level of affordable housing delivery is correct. It's what we want. Clearly we want more. We could argue about the reasons. Certainly the difficulties over the local plan haven't helped. And also there was a complete collapse in the housing market, as you're aware. So there were certainly circumstances outside of our own control. But what we can do now and what we're seeking to do with local plan in place and with hopefully, subject to Brexit, the housing market still being reasonably strong now, hopefully on the right trajectory, we are looking to make those opportunities, to seek them, to seek partners, and obviously we have the opportunity of money down as well, so that's where we are.
And I welcome all of those measures that you want to take put in the strategy to drive forward affordable housing. All I'm saying is this is under Appendix 1 in the Council's main achievements since adopting, and this I don't think is an achievement. That's what I'm just raising. On the bottom of the page it says 13 empty homes were being brought back into use this year. How many empty homes do we have at the moment that have been empty for more than 6 months?
I don't have that figure. We can provide that in a written answer.
My understanding in 2015, and I don't know what it is in 16, is it's 431 units. I welcome it's 13 that you brought back, but in relation to my own ward, we have properties that have been empty for more than 6 months that are a major concern, and I would just ask us, and maybe as a committee we need to look at the strategy in relation to empty homes, because properties that are causing major concerns to the community are empty for longer than, and I wonder if part of this strategy we can do more to bring forward or address empty homes, be more proactive. I think if you look at the figures, how they've come down, there was a blip and they went up again in 2013, but is there anything else that we can do to be more proactive or to do that? I know that taking away the council tax reductions has helped, but is there anything else that we can do as a council to get more homes back into use?
I think we need to understand what we mean by success of an empty home strategy in terms of dealing with properties that may have health and safety issues, building control issues, unsafe structures, or may present public health issues, compared to making a direct correlation between bringing properties back into use through an empty home strategy and assuming that they will part and parcel deliver something that deals with and solves homelessness, because that's not necessarily the case. What we do have is across the council is a range of constituent actions within each of the business units, which each have a contributory impact to the work on empty homes, whether that's about planning enforcement, whether that's about sort of dealing with the various range of issues. One of those in relation to enabling is around fostering relationships with private sector leasing companies. We're currently in a partnership arrangement with Mears, who are now Plexus Housing, I think their name is, so that we can proactively pursue any inquiries that we get around people who want to see how they can deal with their empty property. So I think, we can send you the figures, and we can talk about sort of the comparative figures, but sort of statistically it's not a massive prevalence compared to other areas, and we need to be aware of the proportionality of resources around promotion compared to what actually comes back in.
I understand that it's not a big issue in that it's only 431 across the borough, but the impact of those empty properties on communities is enormous. We have within our ward a small proportion, but though they have a massive impact, and I think it's very negative, and we need to think about what is it we can do. Maybe it's a piece of work that we can do as a committee just to look at it and understand, you know, is there anything else that we could do? So it may be something in the work programme in the future. I've got a couple more questions. Do you want me to stop and come back?
If that's all right with you, Councillor James, I'll bring you back in. Councillor Rattigan.
Thank you. The level of engagement with the homeless and rough sleepers, I think, was covered in Councillor Richards' question. On Councillor Laura James's point about the number of affordable housing delivery, is there a you think there is a possibility perhaps we could wipe the slate clean, look at if it's going to be 300? We know that projects are coming in the future, that maybe if we only delivered 260, we can add it onto the future years, or look at doing that if that's the correct number. But if we're going to deliver for this, we need that commitment more set in stone, or a lower number that we can achieve, and something that we can more readily say this is an achievement because we got to the number that we were trying to get to.
Councillor Reid.
Sorry about that. Yeah, I do take your point, absolutely. Although if you look at the trajectory now for the next few years, with all the new developments coming in, even before we get so many down, we are projected to be ahead of that number over the next few years and sort of rising. So it will eventually, all things being equal, balance out, that if you take sort of a 10-year chunk, we'll be actually delivering the number that we set ourselves.
Councillor Golding.
Thank you. Can I take you to page 26? That's right. It's about people's aspirations and where they kind of want to move on to. And I was a little bit concerned just about the private rented accommodation, because it's so much lower than all the others, which isn't particularly surprising. But my concern is that therefore it's probably less important in your strategy. And yet some of the comments that people are bringing back about the problems they have with private renting certainly ties in with some of the casework I've had. And I just wanted some reassurance, really, that we are doing something to address those issues. And even if it's maybe not a strategy priority, it's not being kind of forgotten about.
Absolutely. I mean, the private rented sector is extremely important, given that at the moment it contains in the region of about 8,000 properties. So it's absolutely important that those units are of a good standard and are well managed. In terms of people's views around the private rented sector, absolutely unsurprising that you get that feedback, and that relates to your casework. When we looked at the demographics of people responding, in the main, a large cohort of responses were coming from people in the sort of, when I say middle-aged, sort of older than sort of early 20s. So people that were already, people that were already sort of progressing through their housing careers, if you like, and may have been, their families may have been growing. So to them, the sort of security that they craved wasn't necessarily available within the private market. That said, you know, there are a number of people for whom the private rented sector, if it's well managed and if it offers reasonably sort of predictable rents in terms of increases, is a good solution. And that's particularly for sort of younger clientele. And we did actually, I'll pass over to Aaron at this point, because we did have quite a comprehensive response from the private rented sector, didn't we, in terms of how that's sort of marketed and seen, because it often has extremely negative connotations. So it's about recognising that if you're going to have a private rented market, it has to be well managed, and it's one that sort of drives good standards.
Just to add to Kate's point, I mean, at the moment the private rented sector is very much a mixed economy, if you like. You've got the accidental landlords and the people who bought the odd property, and then there are some, you know, institutions currently more based in the north than the south, but certainly coming south, that are seeking to offer more, you know, coherent offer, so to speak, and more security. Turnover is not good for them in terms of revenue stream. So there is, and there are a number of private finance institutions are looking to put money behind private rented accommodation. But the reality is, it's almost like the Cinderella of the housing sector. In housing policy terms, it's been neglected for decades, and now suddenly people are waking up to it as an issue, partly because of the range of quality being quite good to being, in some instances, unacceptably poor. So there's a feeling, a need to actually regulate it a little bit more proactively, but government don't quite allow full regulation, full licensing. But there's certainly more work to be done, but in a way we're paying the price for that lack of effort, policy effort and intervention effort that frankly dates back to the war. So, but the sector's growing, so therefore there does need to be an intervention. But it's not for most people, not all people, it's almost like a tenure of last resort. And I think there's obviously a perception issue there that needs to be addressed, but it also does come back to the point that Councillor Reid was making around more options to step out of private rented housing into other forms of home ownership, because basically high rents are eating into people's ability to save money for a deposit, to buy a home in times when interest rates are absolutely on the floor. You know, so it's kind of terrible irony for a lot of people.
Councillor Reid.
I think possibly we need to be perhaps a little bit more visible in terms of what we do to enable people to access private rent as well. As we do, for example, if someone comes to us and there isn't an option other than private rent, we do proactively help and support and guide. And we have things such as a rent bond scheme. But that's not necessarily on every member's radar, so maybe we need to do something just to make members aware of the work that goes on that too.
Councillor Ashfield.
Thank you. I know it's been covered slightly through comments and questions from Councillor James and Councillor Attigan, but given that it was the top summary headline on the presentation was to accelerate development, I couldn't see any real specifics in the paper on how that's going to be achieved strategically or tactically, and I wondered if you could give us a bit more detail, bearing in mind the current uncertainty in the construction market and also the introduction of SIL next year, which I think may lead to some disruption in terms of planning and developments actually getting off the ground.
Councillor Reid.
I'll be repeating myself a little bit because I have already referred to this, but I mean, we, as I say, we've set up this group of senior officers who are proactively seeking development opportunities. So they are actually engaging with partners, with developers, with companies such as Mears, for example, which Kate has referred to, who could help us to actually enable that development as it goes forward. It's not a case of sitting back and waiting for it to come to us, which has been sort of the case, I think, previously. It's a case of actually going out and seeking it, looking for opportunities. And I think the more flexible you are and the more options you give developers, the more chances there are that they will actually respond and come forward. And they are coming to us as well. And I referred to, for example, the conversations I've had with developers and investors. I mean, one of those conversations took place when we had people here to talk about Manydown, for example. And I was talking to them about having our intermediate list as a marketing tool. And they were saying that really would be hugely important and successful in attracting developers, knowing that we already have a list of people who want to access shared ownership, for example. So that's going to be very important, I think, and that they see that as a real plus, because in a way it's almost doing some of their marketing for them, and it's already done before they get here. So it's that work around there.
Just sort of to add an officer comment to that, I mean, there can be absolutely no underestimating the challenges that there are in terms of not only getting new delivery, but affordable delivery at that. But certainly the fact that the council is prepared to invest its resources, it has done recently in terms of a couple of decisions in relation to giving land, in relation to Paddock Road, to stimulate affordable housing delivery, is one example of the sorts of initiatives that we can bring to the table, and we can have that discussion about affordable housing delivery being a priority that cuts across business units and sort of gets us out of the silo working that lots of councils tend to fall into. So it's difficult to describe sort of a culture and of a way of being that's being sort of captured in this document, but that's a sort of example of the way of working that we're talking about.
Thanks. I was really just looking for those sort of anecdotes really that actually support the headline there. And Councillor Reid talked about flexible options, and I understand the benefit of giving marketing information, but in terms of flexible options, are there any specifics there in terms of, you know, I wouldn't like to think that there were flexible options that were going to jeopardise the sort of housing that we're looking for?
A great and most recent example was at Brook House, where we couldn't get any affordable housing delivery because of the nature of the development meant that we couldn't get a registered housing provider. As a result of that, the negotiation was for discounted market sales, and we were able to take a list of people registered with Help to Buy with the zone agent and negotiate with the developer a process whereby they could be introduced to the discounted market sale properties. And the council could sort of verify and confirm, if you like, that people would fit in with the sort of criteria, the prioritised criteria of local connection. Now, that was something that took place without nomination rights, without something that we were necessarily legally entitled to hold up to. But it's an example of how, if you think a bit differently, you can get some results. And we understand that the units at Brook House are under offer, and they're to local people that were otherwise registered on the Help to Buy. So that's a bonus. They may be small wins, but in their totality, they can add up to something.
Councillor Frost.
Thank you, Chair. To be honest with you, my question was really about page 15, the second bullet point from the bottom, about the 253 affordable housing units that Councillor Mrs. James brought in. Even though it is an achievement, I agree it's a... It's a comment, and I also agree with Councillor Rattigan that I'm disappointed that we have actually missed the target, even though there have been extenuating circumstances. And I understand that you know, in the fullness of time, the target will come back to us. Councillor Reid has given a very full and frank answer three times now, as I understand. So I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Councillor James.
I just wanted to pick up on, I'm really sorry, I can't remember your name.
Erin.
You said in when it was asked about starter homes that it was problematic and that it was fraught or something along those lines. The focus of, quite a lot of the focus of the report is based on a product, the starter home product. Could you tell us we're starting to realise that ourselves from the Labour group that this is going to be fraught, this product. Could you tell us what is happening from government point of view that it is seen that it is problematic? What are the problems?
What I think the problems are, yeah. Well, at the moment, the product's described as something that should be under 250,000 in its price, should be less than... 20% of open market value. It should be only available to first-time buyers between, I think, 23 and 40 years old. Anybody in the UK would be eligible to apply for it. So say, for example, you know, 20 homes are available on a particular site in the borough, anybody in the country, so the guidance goes, could apply for it. So that kind of locality rule, which need to say local authorities are particularly keen on, you know, local people getting local priority, is kind of negated here. So that's an issue that I have with that. I think generally local people should get priority. If they can't be sold, then obviously widen the net a little bit. There's at the moment we don't have guidance about what size the home should be. So as I said earlier, as far as I'm aware, looking at the guidance, draft guidance I've seen, could be bedsits, you know, could meet the priority, you know, the allocation requirement through bedsits, to me, unacceptable. I don't think bedsits are really acceptable house type, although useful in certain small circumstances. So they need to be small. And we don't know enough about the qualitative aspect of it, but I'm not aware that we're being told that it's going to be a lower quality product, but needless to say, in design, quality, environmental standards, performance standards, the housing standards are very, very wide. So it's really about how the local planning authority will be empowered, if you like, to enforce the quality and the standards that it wants to see. So it's and also the Starter Homes product is really, should we say, a national imperative, not one based on what is called objectively assessed need. So again, an issue about whether that's what is required. And there's also an issue about people who've got a bit of money, a bit more than average money, being able to afford a Starter Homes product, and with people with a bit less money, probably only being able to afford a shared ownership product. And in my kind of simple world, I tend to think people with least money need a little bit more help. So I think the priorities are a little bit in the wrong way at the moment. Guidance still to come out, not trying to sound too cynical, but this is a yeah, well, I'm wearing my professional hat, so I'm trying to be objective as I can, yeah. But still some concerns.
Catherine James.
But I have to see what happens.
Can I pick up on, in the beginning of the report, it talks about, the qualities impact assessment, where am I? Let me just see where I am. It's page 12, 3.41. The strategy should be monitored to ensure that there is no unforeseen impact on the proposals on any particular group. And then if you go to the end of the report, page 49, and it talks about monitoring and reviewing of the strategy. Those performance targets used to go to audit and governance. Are they still going to be part of that process? Because it's not down there as being that. And I just sorry.
There are a suite of indicators that are reported to the performance panel that the performance panel asked to see, and the indicators that are proposed in the strategy are ones that will be reported and reviewed by the portfolio holder. So there's some of them are the same, but there are slightly different ones. And I think, by recollection, there's always been a quite comprehensive list of indicators around use of bed and breakfast and length of time of bed and breakfast that do go to performance panel.
Because I thought I was quite hopeful that in relation to these performance indicators, they're good indicators. And what I'd like to see is really that they all go to the performance panel. So I'd quite like to understand, if you can give it to me in writing, or all of us, what is the, which ones are going to be going against the key performance indicators in this strategy? Which ones are and which ones aren't, just for us to understand that. And also, I don't know that you've picked up in your point in relation to 3.42 is how are we going to monitor that this doesn't impact on any other particular group more than it should?
There will be a dedicated group of officers who undertook the impact assessment that will be reviewing this on an annual basis. So they will do that as part of the review, which goes to the portfolio holder.
Microphone, Councillor James. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. Can I just start by thanking the officers for a fantastic report. It's really good to see the proactive and aspirational approach that we're taking to these issues. It's really important. I see in the consultation feedback on pages 26 and 27, question two, the most important, extremely important, if that makes sense, was affordable low-cost home ownership. And on question three, again, the highest rating one there was first-time buyers who need affordable low-cost home ownership accommodation. Could you just outline to me how that shaped the strategy and how that's reflected in the outcomes from the strategy, particularly in light of the Housing and Planning Act?
In relation to how that's reflected, I mean, the interest in rented accommodation or social rented and affordable rent was the same bar one person. I think it was 180 said very important compared to 181 low-cost home ownership. So it was comparable. Now, I guess at the moment, when we're looking at a split of affordable housing that's a 70-30 split, the past delivery has been very much, has very much sort of produced more rented accommodation than shared ownership. I think what the strategy is welcoming and in not a prescriptive way either, because each site, each proposal will be different, is that a range of tenure options can satisfy a sort of wider cohort of needs, which are nonetheless needs in themselves. I think we've already talked about the housing register and how you have to have a housing need. A need for accommodation and for social rented accommodation might translate differently to a need for a low-cost home ownership. It could just be about a frustrated desire to do that. I'm not sure how you want me to link that to the Housing and Planning Act necessarily.
Just on another point then, how do you the low-cost ownership list, which is mentioned in the report, I think that's a fantastic idea. How do you see that working?
We're really conscious, taking on advice that Sentinel gave us, that if you go around sort of promoting things and you've got nothing to offer people, that will automatically deflate interest from the outset. So what we want to do, and bearing in mind we don't have a policy approach to prioritising for low-cost home ownership, which is something that we'd need to look at in terms of who should get what if we're given nomination opportunities. What we're doing at the moment, and on the back of the Help to Buy event that we had last week with sort of 300 people, is just harvesting names of contacts. So we're using it as a marketing tool, for example, and we're also using the information that we get from Help to Buy. When we've got the strategy approved and when we've got the mandate to sort of move forward with that low-cost home ownership register work, we can then sort of roll that out to a sort of, so it gives us wider sort of data and information, and that will be very timely in terms of the digital platform work that the council's doing, so it would probably be most cost effective. So what we didn't want to do was create something that was expensive, that was going nowhere and falsely raise expectations. And at the moment, the .mail version that we've got, which is just harvesting details, as I say, is a tiny acorn from which we hope to grow into a list as it moves forward. But we wanted to start work on that straight away.
For what it's worth, I think the only bit I remember my economics A level is the simplicity of a supply and demand graph. And actually, if you can demonstrate that demand to providers, then you will get some of the supply on its most simple level. It tends to work more often than not. Councillor Watts.
Thank you, Chair. Kate, you mentioned Paddock Road. It was this council's policies that left Paddock Road derelict for 5 years. It was the previous deputy leader of the council, Councillor Jawadina, who wanted maximum revenue from that particular site. Until he couldn't sell the site, it's now been put on the market for affordable housing. So it's direct attack of direct consequences of this council's policies it's been pursuing. That site has been idle for 5 years. On bringing empty properties back into, we have a prime example in South Ham and Sandringham Court. It's been idle for, empty for over a year. That was used for homeless women. It's derelict, it's been run down, it's a health hazard. I think that's an urgent need to bring that back into accommodation for needy people. So that's the prime example where we should be really tackling issues on the front line?
I'd say that we are. I mean, Paddock Road, whatever the history of it, has now culminated in a decision to release that for affordable housing. Sandringham Court, there are development proposals that through our enabling function we're working with Affinity Sutton to develop. So absolutely, we are doing that. It's just something that's extremely visible and it does take time. However, that's not to say we're doing nothing about it.
And I welcome that anyway. I welcome the change of emphasis from this council in the last year or so from the previous 10 years we've had of doing absolutely nothing, basically. Well, minimal, you can see by in the report. Just going into sort of more detail, one of the achievements we talk about, bed and breakfast for 6 weeks from 18 to 2 weeks. Is the 6 weeks like a standard bench line, is it? Because we could have some of those families in bed and breakfast for 5 weeks. I wonder if you can just sort of give us details of breakdowns of weeks and families and where have they gone? Or was that too much?
Yeah, that's far too much. Although a lot of that detail does go to performance panel because every case is different. What I would say about the 6 week benchmark, that derives from a statutory instrument that the government imposed on all local authorities that it would be unlawful to use bed and breakfast for a family with dependent children for any amount of time going over 6 weeks. The impact of that unlawfulness is that a local authority could be subject to judicial review. Now, families can remain in bed and breakfast for over 6 weeks for a number of reasons, which may not necessarily be down to the fault of the local authority, in the sense that you sometimes have discretion to continue accommodating people beyond a certain period of time. So, you know, if someone's found intentionally homeless and they're accommodated for a longer period to allow them to find accommodation, that would still nonetheless crank up as one of those six, those cases exceeding the 6 weeks. I think why we use it as a benchmark is so important is that when you have a situation of that we did have of 18 or so families exceeding that, that is clearly not something that's related to individual cases. That's something systemic that's going wrong that needs attention, which is basically formed the backbone of the business case for going and getting some ESPs. So it's about keeping that. I can never promise you that there won't ever be a breach of that 6 week rule. What I can promise you is that there'll be a very good justification for why it may have happened.
Councillor Reid, you're aching to come in on this point, I assume.
Just very briefly. Yeah, that is why the temporary accommodation piece is so important, and that's why it was so important to keep the Joshua Tree and so important to continue with the ESP schemes, which have enabled us to move people on and have options other than just bed and breakfast. I'm just looking at Kate. We have how many ESPs now? 15, but we've got another... Yeah, we've got more money still, which and the money's come from the homelessness fund that we were talking about. So we've got another, 12 to go, I think. Yeah, I think it's another 12 before we renew the scheme. But Central are working hard to access those properties.
Councillor Watts.
I hope we do purchase some more because we don't want people, families going out of town, I believe it's Southampton or wherever we send them to, Slough or somewhere. Going back to the government changes again, the cap to £20,000 a year, which is going to come in 3.5 years' time. Have we got any figures how many people that's going to affect?
We've got a lot of quite detailed analysis that's been undertaken in our housing benefits team by Nadine McKenzie, who's got a lot of data, and I will duly ask her to provide a full written response to you when she's back from.
Councillor James.
Thanks. Picking up on that point, and this wasn't what I was going to say, but I welcome the use of ESPs and that we're not putting people in bed and breakfast. I just was wondering, and I think it's important for us as a committee to understand, is the purchasing of the ESPs, how does that impact on the market? Because obviously I would assume that they're low-cost housing that we're buying, and does that have a direct impact on other people? Obviously it would have. At a time when there's very little affordable housing available, and we're buying that up, it would be interesting for us to really think about that, I'm not saying we shouldn't do it, but I think it's important for us to understand the impact of that.
That's absolutely right. I mean, one thing, ESPs are helpful. They're a sticking plaster. They're something you can do quite reactively, but they're not a panacea. And one thing that to be aware of when you do have those programs and programs that are too large of ESPs is the impact, precisely as you say, on the market. And we don't want housing associations competing against potential first-time buyers and low-cost buyers. The sort of scale that we're talking about per annum is small compared to the number of sales that are taking place. So I think we were quite comfortable that whilst that was a risk, it was not a risk that was significant in any sense. So it's almost something that you're aware of, and no one would recommend ESPs as the sole and only strategy for dealing with homelessness needs at all. They're just one part of a very big jigsaw.
My other question is picking up on what Councillor Goldin said, was that around the rented sector and her concerns about the rented sector. And the homeless strategy focuses on using the rented sector. And my concern in relation to ward work is the quality of that rented sector. And when you place people in the rented sector, how much work is done in monitoring the properties that you place them in? And then how much do you continue to monitor it? Because I have some grave concerns about some of the landlords and who we're placing people with. And I was just wondering so before we place people, do we have a look at those properties or is it, how does it work?
Some of it is self-sought in the sense that people are given the options of looking for private rented accommodation, and they'll come back to us having found somewhere and seeing if they get assistance. If in reality, what's happening at the moment, given the private rented sector, is that there's not an abundance of private sector properties that we can access, partly because of freezing of LHA levels, which has meant that we don't have as much access to it as we did do, certainly in terms of the numbers that we're able to access. And much of our work around private rented sector is about maintaining those good relationships with the landlords that we've got. So I would comfortably say that yes, we would only work with a good landlord, or we wouldn't knowingly work with a poor landlord. The housing standards team has a raft of regulatory tools at their disposal to deal with poor standards in the rented sector, which includes housing association properties as well as private rented sector properties. But that's a completely sort of separate area of work that they could report to you on. The other thing I would say about people that we place in the rent bond, we have a regular inspection program to make sure that those tenancies are being maintained. And obviously that will be risk assessed in terms of people who are most vulnerable and people that we know are fairly certain just have a light touch intervention and overview. But there is a program to make sure that continues. And we have comparatively very few claims on the bond compared to the numbers of bonds and indemnities we've got out there. Because where we can do, we stop those tenancies from failing.
Councillor Goulding.
Thank you. I sit on performance panel, so I just wanted to add some comments. Maybe not. I do find it interesting. It's really worrying. We do look at housing a lot. It is one of the things the panel really does focus on. And we've actually found it quite frustrating in the kind of the measures we've been having for the last period. But because we've got a new council plan, at our last meeting, we discussed the new measures that are coming forward. And actually, it's been a really collaborative approach about housing. So I'm really positive about these because I'm very confident it is going to give us a much better picture of the holistic side of housing and not just B&B and households, because the 6 week figure, it is useful, but you know what, there's always a story, and it's what it's never more than one, and often it is because we are kind of overextending our responsibility, isn't the right term, but we are going over and above to support people. But that sometimes means that our kind of 6 week figure looks bad when actually we're doing really good work, which isn't what we want to see as performance panel. So yeah, I'm very confident in our new figures, and I think this is going to be quite good. And it's really nice that it's come at the same time as the housing strategy, because everything's actually fitting in together really nicely.
Councillor Harvey.
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to pick up the point about the rented sector really again, and just comment on, I think, the impact we've not mentioned yet, which is the dramatic impact of the buy-to-let issue that really does have an impact. And it's really sad, actually, to see a sale property that I know of, that obviously in the circumstances we've lost, went for a market sale, was sold on, and was picked up by a buy-to-let. And you wind up with that situation where the market completely changes, the situation completely transforms. And to see that property, which is at probably at the lower end of the low-cost scale, it was very unfortunate, shall we say, to see somebody who lost that property, who needed it, then being replaced by it, where not by somebody who wanted to buy it as a first-time buyer, but being picked up by the buy-to-let, and then seeing the transformation of that to a completely different point. It's just a point to make, not a point to want an answer to, but I think it's important to raise that and just to give it as an example. The other point about buy-to-let, though, is the way that it does undercut that end of the market. And, you know, seeing one-bed properties running from what were going 130,000, 140,000 at the lower end of the market, suddenly being gazumped and pushed up to 160,000, £170,000, and seeing way beyond the price range of people, even beyond the 250 that you were talking about in the starter home aspect. I mean, you know, it changes the context of the market for those first-time buyers. And you're right, I'm sorry, but all the issues that are being identified cross-party in terms of the Commons inquiries on this into the Starter Home Initiative is going to expose that as not even meeting the requirement of what we're talking about, I think. It's just points to make, and hopefully they can be captured if the committee agree as part of the record that we make.
Councillor Harvey, you've brought me on very neatly to the point I was about to make, which is that the recommendations from this report are views of the committee to be sought. I'm perfectly happy to capture that. Last one from Councillor Harvey. I think it actually picks up on the concerns that were raised by all around starter homes and the need to look into that in more detail, and actually also to reflect the fact that there's further guidance still to come, so we still don't at this point know what it does look like. The other points I've put down as comments that I've picked up throughout the meeting are direct reference to the alternative investment strategy. I appreciate it can't be stated as a particular fund that's being used at the moment, but the committee identifying that as a potential fund for the strategy. Councillor Harvey's point around the risk assessments of the actual actions taken from the strategy and looking into that when it comes to Cabinet. Councillor Rattigan's points, and again echoed, around ring fencing of homelessness and housing funds. The committee's agreed position on noting the difference between the number of affordable units achieved and the number targeted. Councillor James.
Just saying, in the report it talks about gross, but we've had this argument before, and we've all said it should be net.
Can I just ask of the officers and quickly, is the target gross?
This has been thrown around so many times, I'd need to go back and check before giving a definitive. I mean, then either way, it's contextual, isn't it?
In that case, both, if you like. Noting that the number of houses achieved and that they were gross, and making sure that's appropriately referred to. From my personal opinion, I'd like the number achieved to be in line with the target. So if the target is net, then we need to look at the net. If the target's gross, then we'll look at the gross number. The other point I heard a number of times was the support for the engagement this strategy particularly highlights with low-cost housing options and those that area that perhaps we haven't invested our attentions in quite so much in the past. Those are the comments I've noted down. Councillor Harvey.
Just three points I'd like to raise. I guess tests to look to. Will more socially rented stock be produced that meets needs as a result of this strategy? That's a question to be raised. Will the intermediate stock that wants to be delivered actually be delivered in place of affordable rent and social rent? That's a concern that needs to be balanced. And then the affordability. We may want the stock, we may desire it to be delivered, but what is its actual affordability, both to what is built and then what exists, to the people of Basingstoke and Deane? I think three important tests I'll be looking to, I think, and others and colleagues will be, is to the success of this strategy once it's being implemented.
Any further comments from the committee? Councillor Golding.
Thank you. I think the only thing you missed really was our thanks for the work that's been done and actually our commendation that it's very solid. We obviously have some concerns moving forward, but the work that's been done in getting this far is really good.
I'm happy to take that on board and my apologies. Absolutely right that the thanks have been expressed repeatedly by myself and other members. Councillor Frost.
I'd also like to echo Councillor Golding's in the fact that I'd like it noted that we actually have, you know, services that are of national importance, and I think that should be reflected in our comments as well.
Any further comments, committee? Councillor James.
And I know that Councillor Golding picked up on this, but I'd quite like to understand, against the performance key performance indicators, what is going to the audit, and so it'd be good for us to have an understanding about, yeah.
I think if we can have, I suppose it's once performance panel are now in the process of agreeing or have agreed those, what indicators they're looking to see.
Councillor Reeve might have to confirm this. We had a look at them and I believe Cabinet have now agreed them. So I don't know when our next meeting is. But
I think it would be helpful if we could have that shared with the entire committee and clarified. On that basis, I think we'll move on to the next item, if that's all right with you members, which is the Manydown Development Brief and the Supplementary Planning Document. And just while we change offices, we'll have a couple of minutes break.
members if we're ready to reconvene. The next item on the agenda is the Manydown Development Brief Supplementary Planning Document. We have Councillor Raffel with us. We have Jill Fisher and Matt Melville as well. If I could hand over to Councillor Raffel.
Chairman, thank you. Before I introduce this item, I think I should just point out to members that this is going to be the last committee meeting for Jill Fisher. She has been fantastic. I think all of you agree. She's been fantastic with getting us through the local plan. And I think there's only one thing we can do is thank her and give her a little round of applause. I know that officers will be thanking her in their own way during the rest of the week, but I haven't had the opportunity to thank her in public. I wanted to do it last week, and then I realised we had tonight, so I've remembered. This paper comes before committee as a result of policy SS3, where this committee decided very, very clearly that we wanted to have development briefs or master plans for the larger sites within our borough. We said that we wanted to do that because we as councillors wanted to shape that development and effectively make sure that developments didn't come forward and later generations comment upon them and say, how on earth was this allowed? Or why didn't they do it differently? And we have therefore come to the process and through this process, and you'll remember that last week we had a very short paper that I think Jill presented, which outlined that there were going to be a number of these coming forward, and this is the first one for you to consider. You've heard that obviously with the east of Basingstoke site, there has been a lot of consultation behind the scenes and with ward members and other interested groups. And likewise, this comes forward with there being similar amounts of consultation. There is going to be, I think we've all had an email quite recently about the development proposals on Manydown coming forward from the landowner side. And the way this development brief should be seen as a document that has, as it were, been worked up in consultation, not in competition with the landowning side, and in a way that has brought forward the key points that are in the local plan from the policies, and trying, as it were, to be a document that we can reference to when we look at what the landowners bring forward to see whether it satisfies what we want to see on the site. Of course, it isn't, as it were, can't be a prescriptive list, because ultimately it's down to developers to bring forward what they want to bring forward. But at the same time, they will have this in their minds when they bring forward those proposals. So I'm going to ask Matthew Melville now to explain what the report says, outline it to you, and of course I'm here to listen. So if there are tweaks and bits that need to be added or deleted, then obviously that's what this process is about.
Good evening, members. I'm going to kick off with a short overview of the draft development brief in front of you. I think, as Councillor Raffel said, it's important just to stress that this is a document produced by the local planning authority as opposed to the council in its role as landowner. The intention is that the document should become a supplementary planning document, and it would then be a material consideration to assess planning applications coming forward all across the Manydown application. The production of the development brief for this and the other Greenfield sites is a requirement of the local plan. And the document itself and the process by which it's produced does provide some very useful opportunities. So the document provides the opportunity to add details to the policy framework, in particular to policy SS3.10 in the local plan, which is the policy which specifically deals with Manydown. It offers us the opportunity to coordinate development between the different land ownerships within the Manydown allocation, and its production allows us to engage with members, the public, and other stakeholders to shape the outcome. So the map in front of you just shows the area covered by the Manydown development brief and illustrates that it covers land beyond that controlled by Basingstoke and Deane and Hampshire County Council. So the land in the red, really pink colour is the land within the BDBC HCC control. The land in the northwest of the site, the green hatching, is a land identified as country park in the local plan. And you can see around Worthing, there's four smaller, different colours. There's a smaller areas of land ownership that also fall within the Many Down allocation. So the document doesn't seek to prescribe the precise layout of Many Down, but it identifies six objectives and identifies some development principles to achieve those objectives. So I'll just go quickly canter through these in turn. So the first one about the type and mix of homes, there's development principles in there about the delivery of affordable housing, the delivery of plots for self-build and custom-build homes, and the provision of pitches for gypsies and travellers. The second principle about transport and movement has development principles about movement within the site, but also connections outside the site as well, and includes principles relating to things like the link road and future-proofing. The third principle about social and community infrastructure includes principles that guide the delivery of the centres, which can be the heart of the new communities and the schools. The fourth, about environmental quality, seeks to ensure that development responds to and builds upon the site's opportunities and constraints, including its landscape setting and its heritage assets. And it includes sort of development principles around things like the country park, the identification of green buffers, and Worthing Conservation Area and what's so important about it. The objective about design quality has developed principles that seek to achieve a high quality urban environment that responds to local character and includes guidance about urban design principles which are appropriate within this site. And the sixth objective seeks to provide guidance on how the landowners should produce an infrastructure delivery strategy to demonstrate that infrastructure across the allocation will be comprehensively delivered. So just to touch upon timescales and to illustrate the relationship between the development brief and the work that the landowners are doing, after tonight the draft report will go to Cabinet next week and for Cabinet to hopefully agree the document to go out to consultation. The consultation will last 6 weeks, starting on the 1st of September, and will run concurrently with the landowners' consultation on their preferred master plan. And while that consultation is taking place, information will be provided to minimise confusion with the public to make sure it's very clear about the role of us, the local planning authority, against the role of the landowner promoting the site. The comments received as a result of the consultation may result in changes, and then a final version of the document will be brought to Cabinet and Council in December, such that the document can be adopted as a supplementary planning document prior to the submission of the application on the principal site within Many Down. So the recommendation is that the contents of the report are noted and any views expressed by the committee reported to the portfolio holder, am I right? And that these can be taken forward in finalising the draft development brief that will go out for consultation, as I say, later in the summer.
Very good. Questions? Councillor Harvey.
Gordon, I'll go first. Can I thank Jill as well and add thanks for all on the local plan. To say it's been as long as it has and the number of officers that we've got through over the years, Jill, congratulations on seeing it through to the end and appreciate all the effort on that. I really, really do, particularly working with us as members because we can't be easy to work with all the time. I'm conscious of that, but thank you very much. I appreciate the point you're making about the mirroring process, and I think that's important. The conversations that are taking place from a landowner point of view about the key policy priorities, the key issues, if you like, in a mock Many Down Overview Committee context, then feeding into what you're talking about here, are important. Could I draw your attention on that basis to page 77 and also page 111, and specifically just talking about the approach to affordable housing on site? And members won't be surprised to hear me talking about this issue. We've got the development principle that's being talked about in the blue box, and I'm taking it that, as with the local plan, the blue boxes are incredibly important as it were, policy statements for material consideration, and the supporting text is just that, supporting text. On that basis, middle paragraph there, and then on page 111, halfway down the page, it talks about affordable housing, and it's repeated again there. the same sentence, the same emphasis. What I'm talking about is either a site-by-site approach to affordable housing or an overall strategy. And I think I would have concerns, and I'm sure colleagues would, about the idea of allowing it to go site-by-site where we would potentially offer parceled, serviced elements of land to a developer who may then go into the local into the planning process, where we would be negotiating that level of affordable housing site by site by site, where we may then not achieve our aspiration, set against an overall strategy where we may choose to be our part, either the delivery partner or focused in terms of the delivery in a much more controlling way through the joint venture that's being talked about, such that we do deliver the affordable housing that we seek. The problem I've got there is it's a vague sentence, isn't it? It could be read both ways. And I don't know how you tie it down, and I don't know how you make it more effectively, you know, defined, but I think it should be. And I think the context of the 40% affordable housing, particularly in what was said in our last meeting, Chair, and I appreciate the Cabinet members' comment about this, particularly with SIL going into Council tomorrow. If we're saying the land values can now sustain £60 a square hectare of SIL and deliver the Section 106 and deliver the 40% affordable housing, that's okay. But are we really saying that? If we are, that's fine, and I want that commitment given. If we're not, then that raises lots of other questions. So you can see where I'm coming from, and I appreciate you may not be able to give me the whole answer this evening, but I would appreciate a steer at least.
The starting point in policy CN1 of the local plan is that all developments should bring forward 40% affordable housing. And that underpins the starting point for this strategy. And if the landowners were proposing to deviate from that, they would need to provide the appropriate justification with their planning application to do so.
My point is that it may not be the landowners deviating, it might be the person who's coming forward on the parcel of land that we've given them to develop that deviates from it. We may be providing a get out of jail card, if you like, in the context of that, because the 40% is a starting point to negotiate from.
Well, the outline planning application will set the affordable housing requirement across the site, and it's anticipated that outline application will be submitted by Basingstoke and Deane and Hampshire County Council.
Yeah, but the reserve matters will come in from individual developers who then at reserve matters stage seek to negotiate the affordable housing away.
But that would have to be reviewed on its merits at the time. But as I say, the starting point is 40% affordable housing.
Councillor James, on this point.
So picking up on that point, if you look at page 76, it talks about flexibility will include and allow the fine detail on on-site affordable housing delivery to be finalised at the respective reserved matters stage. My concern and what we're being told by officers at the council in relation to Manydown is there's a policy in relation to Manydown, but then we've also got viability in relation to a planning legislation. And we're going to have developers that come forward now and we'll have small parcels of land which are not as viable. And we're now saying, whereas historically Manydown was a zero SIL, we're now saying that it can accommodate £60. And so we're going to have a smaller plots of land, and these developers will be able to, against our policy in planning terms, and that's why we would not support this local plan, because of that viability policy, will get a get out of jail. They won't be able to, they won't have to deliver, and they will be able to show that it isn't viable. And so I think we need to be much more definite here and really think about this. And we have grave concerns as a Labour group that we are going to see less affordable housing delivered on Manydown because of this. Please help us to tie this down more. What else could we do? Because otherwise they are, and we are being told this is one policy, but then you have a planning policy that has viability, and they will get out of this. And think, why have we put £60 in SIL if it isn't achievable, if there's smaller plots and viability will be demonstrated by these developers that they can't achieve it?
I think there are a number of points there, and it does reflect one of the challenges, if you like, of preparing a development brief, because it has to have that flexibility, because we are not at the stage of detailed planning application. So we're setting as far as we can the guidelines and principles that we would like to see this development take forward. In terms of the issue about SIL and affordable housing delivery, certainly the viability study work that we've had done in preparation for the SIL examination suggests that a fully policy compliant scheme is able to deliver those policy compliance and a £60 per square metre charge. Now that's something that will be examined through the examination process, and the inspector at the end of the day, if he or she does not accept that's achievable, given the evidence that's provided, they will make that decision. Clearly viability is, it does move with time and it changes, and issues such as introduction of starter homes, where we don't have the detail of what that means in practice, may change the viability. So viability is a kind of, it's not set in stone, it changes through time. So we'll certainly take away those thoughts and see if there's some other wording that we can come up with in that. But in terms of what we can actually say, we can't pin this down that much more, I would have thought, at this time. The only final thing I just wanted to mention, you were talking about the difference between the supporting text and the principles in the boxes. The whole document will be supplementary planning document, but we've prepared it in this way to try and really kind of tease out the key points and clarify that by putting it in boxes. But the whole document is stands.
Come back on that point. So we were told, I think, is it two dragons or what are they? Three dragons or whatever. So one point they told us, three dragons, that this Mellindown couldn't achieve SIL and it was zero rating. We're now told that it can achieve £60. Tonight we're told by the Cabinet Member for Housing, we don't know what's going to happen in relation to housing because of Brexit. We don't really know in relation to what's going forward in relation to the market and what's going to happen. Is SIL flexible? So if we set SIL at £60 and things go terribly wrong in relation, at what point can we change that? And by that time, how does that fit in with Mellindown? And if things are, you know, not working out well, you know, and is it wise that we do £60 if we're not sure if our absolute priority is to deliver? Because it would be unforgivable if these developers come forward and then get out of delivering. And I just want to put it on record, because we need to monitor this, that it will be unforgivable if they get out of delivering the 40%. And my other point is, as part of that 40%, you talk about some of that being a proportion of starter homes. Is that in relation to the model that's coming down from government, and they're not going to be delivering 106, and has that been factored in? Is it that model that the consultant tonight was talking about?
We haven't factored in starter homes because we wouldn't know how to, because the regulations have not yet been published. So the implications of that we cannot be aware of yet. When that comes through, it's possible if that comes through prior to the examination, that information could be updated. But there is uncertainty with values and the SIL introduction of charges. But you know, one has to go forward on the basis that otherwise, you know, you'd be in a position where you wouldn't do anything. So we have to take this forward, and the examination will be the point at which they will say this, you know, given the current, and by then that'll be 6 months after Brexit, there will hopefully be an indication of where the economy and the housing market is and provide that certainty. In terms of reviewing the charge, the council is at liberty at any point to decide that circumstances have changed and they wish to review that charge and set that review process in line. As was said last week, you know, normally it's considered that you'd need to look at it with 3 years, but there's nothing stopping the authority if that changes to change that. And the third thing, in terms of uncertainty, is that actually the government may look at SIL and how that operates in practice and make changes to. And I think last week Dominic Houston mentioned the peace review, which is considering SIL. So there are a lot of uncertainties, and it would be wrong of me to suggest that there aren't, but we are working on the basis of what we know at the moment. This is what we're proposing to take forward.
Councillor Robinson.
Thank you, Chairman. You might have to bear with me. I've got a number of questions, so go do ask somebody
You'll
else.
You'll limit yourself. Back.
I will try and limit myself, Chairman. Objective 2, effective and efficient transport, page 73 will do. I think it's really important that we think not just about Manydown and the impact on other existing communities. If we look at Development Principle 2A, there's a figure which is on page 80. I've just looked at it and noticed that there is lots of mention on there of specific issues, which is welcome, but there's no mention of any identified constraints to the north of the site. There's no mention of rat running through Rooksdown. There is no mention of rat running through Ramsdale, Monk, Sherborne and Charter Alley. And this is a really big issue, which we've seen through the works on the hospital. When we've got traffic in the north of the town that's trying to get to the A340 and Tadley in the north, and even some of it to the M4, I'd like to know what we're planning to do regarding that issue.
Matt, I'm sure will correct me. I mean, in terms of just picking up that as an issue, then I don't think there'll be any objection with identifying that on the plan. In terms of how that's being dealt with, and I suspect we'll keep coming back to this answer, but a lot of the detailed work on the transport and highways implications of this has not yet been undertaken and is being undertaken by the landowners as part of their preparation for their planning application. So in terms of that detail of how the highway solutions will come out in practice, we won't be able to say that yet, but certainly that a great deal of work in terms of looking at modelling this impact is being undertaken as we speak.
Okay, so if you're picking up concerns on that point, I think that's something that we really need to pick up on, and possibly Rooksdown Lane as a solution to that issue, which might come out later. On objective 6, we talk about integrated master planning and comprehensive infrastructure delivery. And I noticed Matt used the word future-proofing, which I think is really important with this. What is being done for the comprehensive master planning and infrastructure delivery for the whole of the Manydown site, not just the 3,400 houses at the moment, the 15,000 across the whole site?
This development brief is considering what's in the allocated in the local plan at the moment, and we've deliberately, obviously we're aware that there are issues beyond the plan period, but it is inappropriate to kind of make assumptions about that, apart from identifying that may take place and try and do as much work as possible in terms of looking at those impacts. So that's why we've got the future-proofing policy in there. I'll just pass over to Matt if you want to add anything on that.
Just draw your attention to Development Principle 2F, which does seek to ensure that the developers do think about future-proofing as part of the good practice going forward.
That's page 19.
Okay, I understand what you're saying. However, if we're talking about being serious about future-proofing, and in a normal course of events, we would say, what's beyond this local plan we don't know about? In the case of Manydown, we know that the southern side is going to be developed. There's a court order saying that the southern side is going to be developed. For right or for wrong, it's going to happen. So I think it's really important that we look at these issues. And I mean, point 2E on the Link Road, again, we talk about future-proofing and managing speed and designing a link road to cope with the volume of traffic. I think it's really important that we bear in mind that this link road will eventually carry the traffic for both phases of Manydown and a large number of houses. And certainly on the link road point, I'm slightly concerned about the emphasis that's been placed on public transport, pedestrians and cyclists, which are all very important. But that seems to be the focus of the link road piece at the moment. And then we need to be careful, I think, about statements which say managing the speed of motor vehicles. This road is going to carry an awful lot of traffic. If we're talking 3,400 houses, two cars per house, 7,000 cars, we need to make sure that we can get traffic through this site. And I think we need to be careful when we're talking about managing speed and things. We almost, in any other walk of life, you would design a road to spec. And I know that that's not how it works in planning terms. You build a road and then Hampshire County Council rate it and say this is the speed limit, which is unfortunate. But I think we really need to be looking to build a road to spec, which will take traffic at 40, 50 miles an hour through the development to allow people to link up with the rest of the town.
I will move to somebody different. Councillor Watts.
Thank you. On page 89, relationships with surrounding communities. So I support the top statement then that Manydown shouldn't be looked in isolation and should be looked with improving the quality of life of neighbourhood communities. I see this as a prime example of regenerating ever areas, primarily Buckskin and Winkelbury Centre. I think it's your ward, Chair. So I'm just a bit concerned why we have got Beggarwood and Hatch Warren in this statement here. I mean, Beggarwood's going to have an awful lot of development of its own. Handsome Fields, Kennel Farm, the golf club, it's getting lots of 106 SIL money. I'm just concerned that money is going to be diverted from Manydown over to Hatch Warren, Beggarwood, when we've got greater needs in Buckskin and Winkelbury for regeneration. And I'm just wondering why we've put Hatch Warren and Beggarwood into that statement.
The reference is to the community investment strategy and the focus of that document, which is broader than just looking at the impact of Manydown and upon the wards adjacent to it. So the paragraph there about the community investment strategy is setting the context about the work that strategy is doing, not just about how it relates to the Manydown development.
This is a piece of work that's been taken forward by Sue Raiden for the west of Basingstoke. And if you're not aware of that, I'll make sure that that Sue, because there's been, a number of events about that. And so I'll make sure that you get that information.
Just to be clear as well, I suppose on that chapter, on that paragraph, that I mean, it is direct reference to that community investments are actually for Western Basingstoke, and I'm delighted that the paragraph that follows it directly references the Winkelbury Centre, and I think it is just a reference to the wards in that item rather than the reference to the wards that will be affected by Manydown directly. Councillor Rattigan.
Thank you, Chair. On Councillor James's point about the SIL, my residents in Kingsclere were paying £200 a square foot for their SIL and impact. And obviously, I regard that the piece of work done by Three Dragons last week is robust. It wasn't always correct in its assessment of all of the areas of possible development in Basingstoke, but we went through it. It seems robust that they should have to pay something for impact of those houses. It's for the betterment of the whole of Basingstoke, and some of the money from Manydown can be shipped to other parts of Basingstoke, and it is important that it is, because that's where some of the regeneration needs to happen.
I'd rather not go through the wholesale argument
week. I'm just making the point. My two points on this piece of work are a sense of character and pride in the new Manydown development, a sense so that they have a pride in where they live. So I would like to see some sort of strategy to bring a character forward, to have a sense of community, that they're not disparate bits from Redrow or Persimmons or Bloor Homes, that there is a sense of community, not just from the developer. And I feel that is important if we're going to bind the people of this area together. Also on page 78, the self-build and custom building. I just want to have it clarified to me. You've got 5% of the units are to be self-build or custom-built plots. is that 5% after the deduction of the 40%, or is that 5% of the total 3,400?
In relation to the initial point about the local character, there's a chapter in here, chapter 4.5, about design quality, and principle 5A sort of talks about the character development itself, and character, and then 5B then moves on to talk about more specific character areas, which can then help to shape some legibility within the development by. So it's all tied together with a sort of single holistic theme, but there'll be individual character areas within the development, which will create diversity and interest to the development. In terms of creating a new community from the outset, development principle 3E requires a community development strategy to be submitted with planning applications in Manydown. And it's envisaged that the kind of measures that would bring forward to create a sense of community identity from the outset would be things like a temporary community facility, contributions towards a community worker, all those kinds of things which can help to build a sense of community within the new development, but also help to provide linkages with the existing community as well from the outset. Yeah. Sorry, in terms of self-build, the 5% is across the whole allocation.
I just want to say that it's interesting because self-build is obviously a relatively new initiative, and the government has been proposing that. And since the 1st of April, we as a council, as with all other councils, have started a self-build register where people who are interested in self-build or custom build can put their name on that register. And so because obviously we've only just started that process, it's quite difficult at this stage to know exactly what the demand will be, both in terms of how many people want to do it, but probably more importantly, how many people can actually afford or are able to do it. So it's not an easy question, but we've just felt that 5% seemed a good overall target at the moment. It may be in 5 years' time, you know, we have better evidence which actually suggests that figure isn't crisp, but that's the kind of starting point in which we go.
Can I just add that on page 22 or page 87, development principle 3E is building a strong and vibrant new community. Relevant planning applications should be supported by a community development strategy to demonstrate what measures will be provided and when to help build a sense of community identity among new residents and assist integration with existing communities. I hope that answers the points you're making.
Thank you, Councillor Raffel. It is important, I feel, that you know, things like fairs and fates and things like that are really, they bind people together because it makes people spend their leisure time with other members of their community, and anything that this council can do to promote, say, you know, a Manydown day or whatever it is, I would be grateful for. Can I come back on the question of the self builds? You've also got a note in here about custom builds. I'm wondering if that's going to be some large, different housing, maybe glass or, you know, something that's a bit zany, something great that architecturally would push Manydown to a architectural limit to allow people to see us as showcasing the best of what our British architecture can bring, perhaps using new materials, different materials. That sort of thing. How can we promote that, not just here locally, but be a bastion for people to come in and showcase their work?
New initiative and how much that will be taken up, and how the custom build element, which is obviously where you're not necessarily doing the thing entirely on your own, but you're paying someone to do that, and that might be a number of houses rather than one individual house. But I think if John Dawson, who's an urban designer at the council, I don't know whether he might want to just say something in terms of how we, because I think you're right, this is an opportunity to ensure that the development has individual style and isn't just kind of rows of little boxes. But at the same time, you don't want those custom build and self build to be a complete kind of higgledy-piggledy mixture of things. There needs to be some coherence within the smaller areas. And John is much more an expert on that than I am.
With self build developments, you often do get a far greater variety of houses. One house will look different from another and then another, and they can start to approach the kind of streets that a lot of people really like, that were built in, say, the 1930s, where in this run of a street you see lots of different properties. That is what we would expect with self-build. In terms of actually requiring that and making sure that we don't get lots of little boxes, this is why, for both the self-build component but also the rest of the 95% component for the rest of the development, we've got this requirement that character areas have to be put forward. And those character areas will have to go into some sort of detail as to what they will look like. And that's not just the architectural appearance of a building, but it's also the layout, how far is the setback from the house, from the back of the pavement, and so forth. And so we're hoping that we expect that when the outline planning application comes forward, we'll be able to secure this. Now, one thing I wish to point out to you is that in the design section on page 106, we've got parameter plans. Those parameter plans are key things that must come forward at the outline stage. They are very strategic things to do with the main movement corridors, density ranges, building heights, strategic landscape, and so forth. If you look below that, in the design nexus statement, you've got this reference to other things such as character areas, design principles, and so forth. It's part of that work that we would hope to see the sort of detail that we will allow us to secure a much better design development. One thing I need to mention here is that because Menny Down is so large, 3,400, because it's also, it's not really at this point the role of the local planning authority to prescribe in a very different point that this house must look exactly like that, must look exactly like that. It means that this is the sort of work that will be done when the outline, but also when the reserve matters comes in. And so we'll have to see what sort of detail is put in at character area stage. It may be illustrative, but the key sentences that we've put in this document here is that we want to make sure that when an outline comes forward, that we have enough strength in any outline permission, for argument's sake, to require that when the reserve matters comes along, that character areas will come forward and good design will come forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Appreciate your help on this. My final point is maybe we could speak to great architects. We've got Lutyens buildings around here where the greatest architects were inspired to come into Basingstoke. Can't we speak to people who are on the cutting edge, like Hoof House and things like that, to do a development, to see if we could have a piece of architecture, housing, that is cutting edge and sees us through to for another 100 years like the Lutyens building I'm in?
I think that's an interesting thought, and we'll take that thought away, and also take that thought to the landowners, because obviously when they are preparing their plans, that's important for them too.
Thank you, Councillor Rushing. I think it's the first time my eye rolling has been described as helpful and indulgent. Councillor Frost.
Thank you, Chair. I basically have 2 points. The first one, page 83, principle 2E, the link road. I think my colleague to the right of me touched on it to a certain point, but I would like the second bullet point, the final sentence there, which says the link road should be flanked by areas of frontage development of public spaces at various setbacks. I personally like to see that being a lot stronger. Potentially, the link road must be flanked by areas of frontage developments. I'd also like potentially the words kept away in the main from the edges of development. One of the biggest issues that is concerning the residents of my ward of Oakland and North Waltham is the fact that we have what's commonly known as the strategic wink on the B3400. And their biggest fear is that we have this strategic gap, which is 300 metres, and then developers put a road down through it as well. So I'd appreciate that. That's my first point. My second point is more on the page 96. And it's really a question on Development Principle 4E, the ecological buffers to tree belts, woodland and hedgerows. And in there, the second paragraph, we've got important hedgerows on the site, or those hedgerows particularly important for a key species such as dormice, should be given a 5-metre buffer, unless it can be demonstrated that adverse impacts on the hedgerow habitat can be satisfactorily addressed over lesser distance. Would it be possible to remove the lesser distance and keep the hedgerow protection at 5 metres?
With regards to the hedgerow protection, that wording is the wording being advised by our ecologists as being sufficiently robust, and it does provide the starting point of the 5-metre buffer being what we would expect. But we can certainly take that away and give that some further consideration. In terms of the location and alignment of the link road, there are other policies within both the SPD and the local plan which seek to protect the views into the site and the character of the site. And clearly, the road and the vehicles along it and the development around it, were that to be an inappropriate location, that would fall foul of other development principles in this document.
Thank you, Chair.
Councillor James.
Thank you. Page 89. I just want to go back on what Gary was raising in relation to the relationship with surrounding communities. I don't think we should dismiss what this is saying here, because I think it is, and it isn't really going to help you, Councillor Smith, in relation to Winkleberry. I think that very much the focus of this relationship with surrounding areas is this new strategy. We are going to have a presentation on it as a Labour group, but my concern is, if you look at the box, it's very much focused on that strategy. And as Gary was saying, what we would want to see in there, and what it's saying is that the potential Manydown is to improve the quality of life for neighbouring communities. And there's no mention in here of regeneration. We've got areas aboard, which is in Buckskin and Winkleberry and in Southam Extension, that desperately are crying out for regeneration. And there's no mention of that here. But it very much focuses on the strategy. Then it goes on to talk about artificial grass pitches and sports halls. And I can just see what's going to be coming in relation to that Manydown will be supporting and could be supporting Beggarwood and Hatch Warren in delivering those facilities. I don't know if that's what we want, but I think that it's a missed opportunity. And I would ask us to think again about that whole section. And it gives me concern, because it's very much just about this strategy to the west of Basingstoke, but it's about something different to what we want to see. And I would want to see more emphasis on regeneration and how we can actually address the inequalities, because it goes on in the third bullet point to talk about poor access to healthcare, poor quality facilities in Winkleberry Centre. But it then relates to a strategy which isn't going to address those issues. And that strategy is a community strategy. And I really think that we have to put greater emphasis on the inequalities and what is Manydown going to do, because this is an opportunity. And if we don't do something, we're going to miss the opportunity to address some of these issues as a benefit from Manydown. And I know that you didn't want to talk about this, Chair, in relation to SEAL, but can I just ask a question? Manydown is out-of-town centre, is classed as out-of-town. Who will benefit from the SEAL on that site? So we were given a presentation last week to say, you know, who's going to benefit from development. So it isn't in the town centre. So we in the town won't benefit from it. So Winkleberry won't benefit. I just wanted to...
Can I just clarify very quickly? I'm not trying to help Councillor James. Do you mean with regards to the 25% or 15% that goes to... Fine.
And so, you know, and I think it's important in relation to this issue, particularly in relation to the relationship with surrounding areas and the benefit, not disbenefit, of Manydown. I think we have to understand that, and I didn't ask that question last week, and it made me think about this. So if, could you just, I know it's out of, it's away from this, but if you could help me.
In terms of the point about regeneration, certainly office is going to have a look at that, and if the portfolio holder wants to kind of suggest those changes at Cabinet, we can make some of those minor word changes. The other point I would say is that this actually is a draft for consultation, and it is very likely that we will have a number of comments as part of that consultation. So this isn't the final version, and obviously that will be taken back for approval before it is approved. In relation to SIL and who benefits, where the housing is delivered, is built, is where that 15 or 25% will go. So if it's in the parish of Oakley or Wootton, St Lawrence, it will go there. If it, so that's where that element. But in terms of the overall SIL benefit, then the SIL, if there is any SIL paid by Manydown, because of course it is possible that will get permission prior to the introduction of SIL. We don't know which time, well, the timing of that yet. But if that's the case, then that money is used for the benefit of the wider area, and it is for council to decide on its priorities in terms of the SIL spending. But and that then takes us into the discussion we were having last week.
So just picking up on that, so if you look at, and I know this is digressing a bit, but in relation to Manydown, Wootton St Lawrence will benefit from, I think it's 15%, because it's a parish, but it's not got a neighbourhood plan. But Oakley will get the 25%. I don't think Winkelbury gets anything. And I'm just wanting to raise this, particularly in relation to this section. So I urge us all to really think again about this. And we had concerns, didn't we, about who was getting what. But I just want to pick it up here. But please, can you, Cabinet Member, think about this section again?
Councillor Raphael.
I made it abundantly clear at the last meeting what we were going to do. And everyone nodded and said they understood that. But shall I say it just again? We are going to be bringing a paper back to this committee which will discuss the means and the methods of spending this money, because we understood that the non-parished areas are currently not or don't have any definition for how that money can be spent, and that can't be right. So we're going to bring it back, and how the money is spent could be that we agree a method that leaves it to officers, or it could be we devise a method that has close contact with members in relation to every site, or it might be some balance between the two, but we can't say now what it's going to be. It needs to be designed and needs to come here for those members in particular who feel they won't be benefiting from SIL to say how they feel they should benefit from SIL. So that's what I made clear.
You missed my point. That's fine, and I did understand your point, and you may think I didn't, but I did understand it. What I'm saying is Manydown is classed as being out of the town centre, so it links to the parishes. So what I'm saying is Winkelbury, in which it says on the third bullet point down here, is the inequalities and the concerns about health and all of those issues, is not going to be one of those areas, non-parished areas, that's going to benefit from SIL. So that raises a concern for me, but I just ask that we look again at this whole section, and it's a missed opportunity. It's a really missed opportunity, particularly if you're not going to get SIL. You know, you've really got to think again about this whole section.
I'm not sure that it's quite right to say Winkelbury won't be benefiting from SIL, because the parish areas are capped.
I think perhaps talking cross purposes a little bit, Councillor James is correct that the parished amount, the 15 and 25%, will not go to Winklebury. It will go to, wouldn't say Lawrence and Oakley, which I think is a point that's being made. Yes, Winklebury will benefit from SIL in a broader sense, potentially, but we'll bring that paper forward when we do. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. I just thank Councillor Fell for outlining that fairly clearly and the chairman for outlining that. I think that's really important that we bring that back, because there is still, even if we give the parishes 15 or 25%, there is still 85 or 75% of SIL to distribute in areas such as Winklebury, which I'm sure that the chairman will wish to be spent in those areas. Development principle 4B, responding to the wider landscape. I'd just like to say I think that's a really good section. I think we certainly need to keep that. I think it's really important that we bear in mind the topography of the site and make sure that we respect the fact that we don't want high rise on pieces of land which are already high, etc. And I know that's something that we talked about at a meeting a month or two ago. So I think that's really important. So we need to keep that. On development principle 4G, provision of the country park, just a small point. The country park should provide for, point B, visitor facilities and car parking accessible for many Down residents. I think that point on car parking needs to be thought through incredibly well, because there are a number of traffic concerns around, and I just think we need to look at that in great detail when we get to that. I'll stop there, Chairman, for the moment.
Councillor Harvey.
Thanks, Chair. Just finishing off on page 89, appreciating the conversation and the debate that's been had thus far, I think it would be interesting and important to perhaps have the specificity in that paragraph, in that section, on regeneration. Nothing more than that. It's just the point about the specificity of that, such that it isn't left to you having to have a bidding war with somebody else on the section 123 list later down the line. I think if we miss that opportunity, and that's what we're saying, so that we have that captured purely in the context of the adjoining wards and the benefit therein. Similarly, so my question relates to 85 and 3B. The last sentence of the first paragraph. The main shopping and commercial facilities should be located in the centres unless it can be demonstrated that it is not practicable or desirable. I just like to understand what the get out of jail card is there in the context of our expectation of that. How might that sentence be used, and what do we mean by it? And in thinking through that section on local centres, one of the concerns is, obviously we've got the Winklebury Centre, we've got other shops in Winklebury directly that will have a relationship to what happens on the estate. Where do they rest with their relationship with the new and the old, particularly if we're talking about regen? What happens to those shops in the Winklebury Centre in that context, and Elmwood Parade and so on. The other bit in terms of that is, if we're citing it on the edge, then again that has a transport implication. That has an implication in the context of the design code, the idea of where we might seek to put those elements of employment in the context of the centre. I mean, a district centre is just that, meant to be the heart and the soul of. We're talking about perhaps a couple of centres or a high street context to what's being debated. That's fine if it is in the centre of Manydown. If we put it outside of that, then it will have implications for the adjoining wards and implications for how we look at movement of people across the site. And again, I just want to get that in my head as to what you mean as to what's been suggested at the mock, because that's where I see a conflict, actually.
There certainly isn't intended to be a conflict, and it sets out the principle that the starting point, that those facilities should be located in the centres, and that is the starting point. There may be exceptional circumstances where, if there were perhaps the sports facility was away from the centre, you might wish to have a cafe next to the sports centre, or it just allows for other eventualities which may be considered on their merits. In relation to the element about practical and desirable. Okay. Sorry, so the sentence that Councillor Harvey refers to is that the main shopping and commercial facilities should be located in the centres, which I think is a principle that we can all agree with. There's a caveat at the end, unless it can be demonstrated that it's not practical or desirable. We can certainly take that away and give it some further consideration. Then there may be exceptional circumstances where that there might be specific circumstances, but certainly the thrust of the policy would be to locate it around the centres.
Totally appreciate what you're saying, but then again, what you're saying isn't the main. This says the main. If we're saying, well, God forbid it's a Costa, we add that to the context of a sports facility. My goodness me, how many Costas are we going to breed in Basingstoke? They're multiplying all over the place, aren't they? The point being, that's not main. That's the bit that captured my interest in terms of what we were trying to achieve here.
I don't think there was anything meant apart from the fact that we are aware that the development brief has to have some flexibility and can't be prescriptive. There is no agenda that I'm aware of in relation to that statement.
I mean, from my own humble opinion, the use of the word "should" seemed sufficiently malleable for most to not warrant. Well, I mean, actually, I think it's probably in line with your point, Councillor Harvey, that to my mind, with the use of the word "should" there, you could probably lose the "unless" bit and "thereafter," personally, because it shouldn't. If it can't be, then there should be a reason why it can't. Just my own humble opinion. I think you're absolutely right that actually where the centre is dictates all the points Councillor Rattigan was making, dictates the relationship with neighbouring wards, both my own and Winklebury, which has been repeated time and time again, which I quite like, and Buckskin, and in fact the villages that surround it and Rooksdown. So I think it's a fair point. Councillor Robinson has changed his mind.
Yes, it was just on that point I think should make sense. I mean, the only time where I could see that perhaps it wouldn't be practical or desirable is if it compromised the integrity of the link road. We wouldn't want to pedestrianise an area of the link road if we had a centre in the middle there, which would be an issue, perhaps. That was something that came up at the meeting a month ago when we had the supplementary planning meeting with the officers, that we wouldn't want the link road to be compromised. We'd want service road style arrangements for centres, etc.
Do the officers have any comment on that? No. Fine. From my own opinion, I personally agree that I wouldn't want to see the link road compromised in that sense. Does anyone else have any further comments? Members, we are, as it says, here to note the report, and any of our views expressed are reported to the portfolio holder, who's sitting here taking notes, and they can be taken into account in finalising the draft development brief. Councillor Fell, do you have anything you'd want to say? Or
yes, thank you.
Brevity is a wonderful talent. Members, I think we've made a range of comments. For what it's worth, and for the sake of clarity, there are some that I've picked up. I will start with one of particular ward interest, which is ensuring the impact on neighbouring area and neighbouring wards is recognised, particularly for those directly neighbouring, and in fact introducing the word regeneration where possible. I think that's a real key issue from a very selfish ward member's point of view, but I'm delighted that other members mentioned it, so I can be justified in saying it. There were comments regarding the affordable housing mix on Manydown, which I'm sure you've taken on board. Comments regarding the constraints to the north of the Manydown site, and a range of concerns regarding the link road as well, which I think I'm sure you'll have taken on board. I think that we're all pleased to see reference to future proofing. We want to make sure that's part of the process. And then the other key reference I had was regarding the strategic gap and the importance of that. I will have forgotten something, I'm sure, members, because I was trying to do everything else. Regenerations I mentioned specifically, yes, but just to reiterate again, because I like saying that word, regeneration, it's important. Jill.
The only other area where there was some discussion this evening and some other discussion with Cabinet is in terms of the ecological buffers. And so there's some picking up some minor changes about that, but that's great, thank you.
I think I might know something about this, because I think it came up in the 2-1-1 session that I had with the officers on this subject. Can I just ask for a bit of clarity, and then I'm all done on it. Matt, is this about
what can be included in the buffers and what can't? And can we just kind of share that with the rest of the committee briefly?
So it's just provide a little bit of greater clarity about what can be included in the buffers and to move some of the wording out of the supporting text into the development principle itself to give it more prominence. So words have been added to the main principle to be clear that uses within the buffers should maintain the green character of those buffers and should incorporate the appropriate design and materials. So some of the wording around that and the specific reference to cycle paths and footways, which was previously in the supporting text, has now been removed.
Fine, well that's been shared with all of you.
Because we're not quite sure that footpaths and cycleways are made of tarmac or concrete constitute green buffers. Logical green buffers either.
Can I just clarify? It's specifically because ecological buffers, the purpose of them is to protect biodiversity rather than just being landscape corridors. And we just wanted to be absolutely clear that that's what it's doing.
Well, I'm sure that that's a view that the committee is broadly in agreement with, so we're happy to consider it one of ours. Thank you, members. That's the end of that item. We'll move on to the committee work programme and the review of that work programme. We have had quite a few things that have been raised. I have one work programme suggestion form already attached to the agenda. I have a second one that I hope has already been distributed to all members. Yeah, it has. So everyone's had a sight of that. To start off with, can I ask Councillor Robinson if he'd like to say a word to his work programme suggestion form?
It will be a very brief one, Chairman, because everybody's got the form in front of them. I think something in conversation with a number of councillors that's really important is that we look at the provision of affordable housing across the borough, and we should look at how we deliver that in the best possible sense, and it's as simple as that.
Might I suggest, in line of the suggestion form and the background proposals you put in there, that we look at forming a working group, task and finish group, to do a piece of work on this that can come back to the report, come back to committee, so you can actually have a slightly more in-depth look at it, if that meets members' approval. Can I also request, using a chairman's prerogative, that in light of the conversations today, that working group, when looking at affordable homes, also includes looking at starter homes and anything that does come out from that. I think as much information as we can get as early as possible, the better. Councillor Harvey.
And I'm just going to push back a little bit and say we would like to be reassured that it will most definitely look at socially rented housing.
I hope that it will look at the entire mix, including socially rented housing and starter homes. Can I ask for some members who would be happy to sit on that task and finish group? Councillor Frost, Councillor Robinson, Councillor Golding, Councillor Ashfield, Councillor James. And we will invite Councillor Parker, if he's able to. And Councillor Harvey, fine. We also have a work programme suggestion form from the Labour Group as an entirety. Councillor Harvey.
Thanks, Chair. Has it been? We've got copies. This relates specifically to the E in the title of the committee. We've looked an awful lot at housing. We've discussed the local plan to death. But one area I think that's really important that we have a very careful and serious look at is the council's economic strategy. Over the years, we've had some very good presentations as part of it, but never looked at the economic strategy in the context that we've set. Now we have the local plan. Now we have key elements of other policy falling into place. I think it's an absolutely appropriate time to look carefully at this council's overall economic strategy and its position as fit for purpose in the context that we would all see it being. And that's the purpose of setting up this particular piece of work programme.
Can I thank the Labour Group for this item? I stole my thunder, but that's all right, you did it with Winkleby as well today. I'm delighted to be on the same side as you for once. I think it's a brilliant suggestion, and I would like to suggest that we bring forward that piece of work to the January meeting so that officers have time to put forward something that is, it's a very broad thing, and I think that's correct. I think we need to look at it in the broader scope we can, and I'd like to suggest that for the January meeting of the Economic Planning and Housing Committee. In terms of other agenda items, Councillor Harvey.
Seeing as it's going to officers work on this, would it be worth us establishing a group to help the officers scope out where we go with this leading to January?
To be frank, Councillor Harvey, I thought you'd done such a good job as a group on your item. I think we want to look at it in a broad sense, certainly at that point. I'm happy at that point if we decide as a committee there are specific bits we want to follow up on. But in terms of the scoping, I think it covers most of it here, and I'd like to have that piece of work done first and that item first. For September's meeting, members, we have the Sentinel Housing Association governance arrangements. At our last meeting, we also talked about, I've got to find my next piece of paper, about the affordable housing viability, particularly in terms of planning applications. And I believe we've got a report that I'd like to bring, well, I'd like us to see for that meeting in September on that. And then moving to November, we will have the East of Basingstoke SDP coming forward. We had hoped that would come in September, but it looks like that's going to be delayed by our colleagues down at the County Council. And we also talked at the last meeting about Section 106 and having a look at where that is and doing a piece of work on that. So we'd like to bring that forward to November's meeting as well. Councillor Harvey, do you have something to say?
I do a couple of things to suggest. At an appropriate point, and I think within the context of this year, it will be worth having the GX of the bid come in for a conversation. We said that last time round. I think it was agreed that it was a good idea. Fitting that into the timetable, I think, would be appropriate. The other aspect that we could look at, which I think is fairly important as one of the leftover pieces of the local plan, is that we have significant development within settlement policy boundaries. I'm thinking here specifically of the town that we haven't examined. We've gone specifically in terms of the local plan, and we've talked about site-specific development briefs for each of the major strategic sites. But what we haven't actually done is look at the context of development within the settlement policy boundary, because that is purely and utterly governed by the policy framework alone. And I think it's worth us just examining the implications of that with officers. And I'm thinking particularly of some of quite significant sites, actually, that are going to come forward inside the town area that would be worthy of us having a look at. And some of them are 600-unit sites, you know, like the one that we're seeing now come forward in Chapel Hill. Some of them are small, 100-unit sites. But it's worth us having a look at that and give them just as equal examination as we have done some of the rural areas and, for that matter, the big strategic sites.
I don't think there's anyone that would disagree, so we'll go back and talk to the officers and come back with a timetabling suggestion. Thank you. Councillor James.
I think on that point, it's the cumulative effect of those smaller sites, and that's what we want to understand on communities. So it's how that, and that's what we want to look at, really. So, I mean, Gary obviously has concerns in relation to what's the site you...
It's the timetable as well, because the sites we identified in the SLA a few years ago, we haven't reviewed the SLA for a couple of years. I can't remember the timetables for all the development in the settlement boundary and the implications of what when that development happens. I think there's an over 1,000 homes.
I think we're in agreement. I think if we could liaise with members to make sure we get the right document, and I'd like to liaise with all committee members actually on that to make sure we get the right report coming to the committee, but we'll do that and then we'll timetable that with officers. Councillor James.
Not for now, but can I just flag up from the earlier presentation on the homeless strategy that I think that we should really look at empty homes again at some stage. We have looked at it before, but at some stage we should review that policy and how it's working. But also, and I think this hasn't really been looked at in detail as a committee, is regeneration and our regeneration strategy. And I think that we should look at that and have an understanding where that's going and how that's working in relation to delivering and driving forward housing, and also in relation to the indices of deprivation and all of those indicators. And so I think that we ought to, at some stage, bring regeneration forward. Whether it's this year or next, but I want to just flag it as something we should do.
The point is well made and appreciated. I've got a feeling there might be something coming on regeneration at some point in the next 12 months or so.
We've also asked to look at that, so we'll go back and check.
I think we'll have to, we've got a meeting of chairmen coming up, and I think we'll look at that element then.
I had some other stuff, but I've lost my train of thought, forgive me. I got to November, when we Easter Basingstoke and the Section 106 process and governments. January, we'll be looking at supporting people, kind of a year on, having kind of seen what's happened that last year. So it'll be 12 months as last update, and there should be a few changes there that we can have a look at. And then at the moment for March, we have the SIL governance structure and spend process put in place. So that's obviously the point that Councillor Raffel was making about what happens with the SIL once we start to get it in the future. I think that covers everything from my point of view. Do any members have anything else they'd like to say? Oh, just sorry, forgive me, to come back. Councillor James, on the empty homes, could we have a work programme suggestion form? And what my instinct tells me might be quite nice to do that is to do another task and finish group to look at that as well, because I think it's quite a tight topic that could quite easily be done by a group of committee members and then to come back. And that's everything from me. So thank you all very much for your patience this evening. And I'll see you tomorrow.